Thank you. So thank you, David, for the introduction. My name is Benoit Dupont. I'm a professor of criminology at Université de Montréal, and I'll be presenting work I did with my student Estelle Ruelan, who should be watching on YouTube. Today's theme is on the impact of police operations. My presentation is not on the impact of police operations. It's more on the structure and the nature of collaboration between the organizations, the police organizations carrying out those police operations. So it's going to be more like the environment or the landscape of what's happening in policing. And then I think many other people are going to talk about the impact during the rest of the day. The main challenge of those police operations, as everyone knows, is that cybercrime obviously is a global problem resting on the global internet infrastructure that knows no boundaries, so collaboration between cyber offenders all across the world has become much easier. But the impact of those cybercrime activities is very local and has to be addressed by police organizations that operate on national or regional or even municipal jurisdictions, so they don't necessarily have the capacity to address this global problem at the local level. So we have a global problem created by cybercrime. And of course, this is one of the reasons very often advanced to explain why policing organizations have not been as successful as expected, and they seem to be powerless to address this type of crime. And of course, in the darknet, this has all been compounded by the fact that encryption technologies used on the darknet, either to browse content or to conduct financial transactions, make it even more complicated for law enforcement to try to break those cybercrime rings and to try to penetrate and infiltrate those cybercrime networks. However, police organizations have been active, and this is a press clipping or a news release from a very recent law enforcement operation called Dark Hunter, I think, by the Department of Justice and many other police organizations. International cooperation. First word of the release is international law enforcement operation. So it's really about working together, and a number of arrests, 150 arrests, and seizure of weapons and drugs and money, $31 million. So obviously, you know, police organizations, they still can do things to try to address this darknet, illicit activities on the darknet as a problem. So the research question I was interested in when David talked to me about today's webinar and seminar is can we understand a little bit better the overall structure of all those police organizations from all those countries, and maybe sometimes the private sector, and maybe sometimes prosecutors, and how they work together to take down those darknet marketplaces and to arrest people? So part of the answer, David conducted, he mentioned interviews, wonderful interviews on Teams and Zoom with people he found on LinkedIn. The data that David's team assembled comes from a different source, complementary to the interviews. It's coming from the press releases, news clippings that the student collected every single time a darknet police operation was mentioned in the press. And we try to use that data to conduct social network analysis. So usually, if you're a criminologist, you've seen plenty of studies on social network analysis of crime networks and trying to understand who's a key player and who's doing what. We are trying to apply the same types of techniques, but to understand not cyber offenders, but how police organizations work together. The technique we're using is two-mode networks. So usually in social network analysis, in criminology, researchers use one-mode data. So you're trying to understand within a cybercrime group how people are connected to each other, or in organized crime group, across different groups, street gangs, for example. You're trying to understand who's talking to whom, but this is the same class of entities, people, members of the same group. There is another approach which is called two-mode data, two-mode social network analysis, where you are trying to map the linkages between two sets of entities. So, for example, it could be criminology researchers collaborating on papers. So how are criminology researchers, professors, connected through their collaboration on different papers? It could be company executives sitting on the boards of different companies. So you have the two entities, the persons and the event or the organization to which they contribute and to which they participate in. And the assumption here is that if you have enough data, there might be a pattern of people assembling together to do things together. So if you have a higher proportion of the same people participating in the same types of activities, then maybe it tells us something about what's happening between those people, the trust, the collaboration, the resources they're sharing, and if they're not connected to the same extent, maybe they're a bit more at the periphery of the network. So this is what we are trying to determine using the data that was collected by David's team. The data covers 7 years of activity, and this is from the type of sources. So sometimes the panels that the law enforcement organizations put on the marketplaces that were taken down, news releases, press clippings. So over 7 years, we assembled information about 121 police operations all around the world targeting the darknet. And we tried to identify all the organizations mentioned in the press clippings or the news releases about those 121 operations. So we tried to be as systematic as possible to record all the organizations, and we were able to capture about 259 organizations. And you might say, well, this is probably a little bit biased because they don't always mention all the participating organizations. Well, this is something I learned when I did my research on the police. When police organizations work together to take down an organized crime group or to have an operation, they're very specific about wanting to be really mentioned and acknowledged in their contribution. So it's very thorough usually, and they have lots of negotiations to make sure they appear. So actually it's something that we can be, you know, not 100% sure, but it's quite, I'm quite confident that when there is a press release, pretty much everyone is mentioned, unless they have a very secretive role in this operation. And the outcome of those 121 operations, just if you want to know, are about more than 3,000 arrests. So when I hear that the police is not doing much and that they're powerless, well, maybe they're not arresting as many people as they'd like to, but they're still arresting an awful lot of people. So this is for the general organization of the data. To provide you some more statistics, and I know that the people on YouTube will see nothing at all, so maybe we'll make the slides available to some people who want. But this is some descriptive statistics about the data. So in terms of the police operations, on the upper left side of the slide, you see that there has been a slight increase between 2019 and 2020, with 52 operations in 2020. The only reason in 2021 why you have only 8 operations is because we stopped capturing the data in March. So if we had kept on capturing the data, probably would have been at the same level as in 2020. So we can tell you which organizations were the most active in those operations. So the FBI, unsurprisingly, was number one, being involved in 47 operations. Then came Europol, 38, but Europol being not a law enforcement organization per se, it's a coordinating entity, so that's interesting. And then the US DOJ, ICE, US Postal Inspection Service, and then, and this is the start of something I was a bit surprised about, the Dutch National Police with 26 operations, and then the German police. And of course, the size of the Dutch police and the German police is nowhere near the size of the FBI. So that's quite interesting that they appear quite high at the top of this ranking of police organizations or organizations involved in darknet operations. And you don't see other countries like Italy or France that have police forces about the same size or bigger, larger than the Dutch and the German law enforcement organizations. In terms of the types of operations, the outcome of those operations, you'll hear a lot more about arrests and impact and displacement, but most of those operations involved some type of arrest on top of seizures and searches of premises. The types of organizations involved, 53% were police organizations, but quite a few other law enforcement agencies were also involved. 20% were law enforcement other than police. So it could be border policing, could be postal police agencies, could be a range of other law enforcement organizations. Prosecutor's offices also involved to a significant extent. Private companies, only 6% of the partners or the organizations involved were private companies. And I did another research on cooperation and against cybercrime in more generic settings, and the private sector ranks much higher. So it seems that in darknet operations, the private sector is not as involved, or maybe its involvement is hidden a bit better. And some NGOs as well, 2.5%. International organizations, I was surprised, but there are not that many of them. So that's it's natural, it's only natural that they rank not as high. And some health and anti-money laundering organizations as well. So health, because they want to try to seize marketplaces that traffic in medicine or pharmaceuticals and so on and so forth. And finally, in terms of the countries involved, leading operations, the U.S. obviously is leading 45% of the operations. So really number one active country to take down darknet marketplaces is the U.S. Number two country, Germany. So Germany seems to have invested quite heavily into taking down darknet marketplaces or arresting people active on those marketplaces. Number three, Netherlands. So you see you have a discrepancy. You have a big country everyone is expecting, but you have two smaller countries that really show up very high and seem to have dedicated a significant amount of resources to impact the disruption of those marketplaces. And then you have, as you know, UK, France, Canada, Australia, Europol not being a country, but being a transnational entity, so I thought it might be interesting. What doesn't appear here is Interpol. So Europol seems to be much more active in those operations than Interpol. And I'm not a law enforcement officer, so maybe some people have explanations or reasons for that. So when you map all those connections between operations and organizations, this is what we come up with. So the black triangles are operations, and the dots are organizations. And the ties are an indication of which organization was involved in which operation. And the size represents the number of operations. So the larger the size, the larger the number of operations were conducted. So you see FBI right at the center, so meaning that FBI was really seemed to be coordinating a lot of operations and to be involved in a lot of operations. And then all the organizations I mentioned, American to the right, and you see to the left, upper left, more European organizations. So you see visually the social network analysis, the representation really shows there are two hubs. You know, American actually, no Canadian involved to a fair extent, and then Europe, with Europol at the center, and then national police forces around with this kind of high representation of the Dutch and the German police organizations. And then you have some smaller operations to the right-hand side, for example, one police organization arresting a few people in their own country. So mainly those operations are in Latin America or Asia, where they don't seem to be connected so much to those hubs in the US and in Europe. That's all very interesting, but if you just look at the map, it's not going to tell you much. I mean, it's going to tell you a little bit visually, but you can dig a little bit deeper. So what we did, we used three centrality metrics to try to understand a bit better, and we used degree centrality, closeness centrality and betweenness centrality. So degree centrality is the number of operations into which an organization participates. So how active you are, what kind of capacities you have, and how committed you are to this type of activities. Closeness centrality is not about your level of involvement, it's more about with whom do you collaborate on those operations. So with whom do you regularly share intelligence and work together to take down those marketplaces? And betweenness centrality is it's not only with whom, but with whom who doesn't work together apart when they're connected through you. So with whom do you collaborate that you put in touch that would never be able to work together if you weren't there as an organization? So the metrics for those two centrality scores give you those three different representations: how active you are, how good of a team player you are, and how unique you are in your ability to connect organizations together. And usually they differ quite significantly. Not in this case. In this case, the main players are pretty much always the same, whether it's in degree centrality, closeness centrality, or betweenness centrality. At the top, you have FBI and Europol alternating. And then you have national law enforcement organizations, including always the Dutch and the Germans. So they're really part of this big group of players, and actually the UK and the Australians, part of the Five Eyes community, they appear sometimes, but right at the bottom, behind Germany, behind the Netherlands. So for me, without even looking at the interviews, that's an interesting story, because you know, if you don't listen, you don't do the qualitative interviews, what are the reasons for the Netherlands and Germany to be ranking so high, so close to the US, so close to organizations that have massive resources 10 times as important as the budgets that those organizations are receiving? And what's interesting is that they're not disconnected. When we conduct using UCNet core periphery analysis, so it's a technique that uses a genetic algorithm to try to find the most dense grouping of organizations and operations, we see that there is a core group of about 10 organizations that seem to systematically work together on those operations. And then there is the rest of the world. So you have this very dense group of 10 organizations, and those organizations are the US law enforcement organizations, Europol, the Dutch National Police, and the German police. And all those organizations, they seem to be really tightly coupled. So they seem to be exchanging resources. And if there is the Dutch National Police, my hypothesis and the German police is that the resources are not given away to them for free. It's probably that they're also giving something to the other bigger American agencies and sharing some interesting insights that the American agencies couldn't do without. So that's an interesting question. And I know we have Dutch and German law enforcement officers, or at least people familiar with that, and I'd like really very much to hear about whether I'm totally off chart or actually there is something to it that was detected by the social network analysis. And the factions analysis being conducted using the same software produces exactly the same results, except that the UK NCA and the Australian Federal Police show up when you do a factions analysis by contrast with a core periphery analysis. So using a different algorithm shows up a couple more police organizations coming from the Five Eyes community, which was to be expected. But still a very tightly coupled network of organizations. So what it means is if you're an offender and if you live in the Netherlands or in Germany, maybe I would advise you to move to another country, because those two countries seem to be really effective at identifying and arresting darknet operators. If you're in the US, maybe also you can move to another country or don't travel to the US. So I think this is pretty much all the time I have. So in conclusion, I think that, you know, this idea that the darknet is a Wild West I think, should be abandoned. It's not a Wild West. You have a lot of police organizations, even the ones not connected to the core. They're still very active, and there is a point where the core members are going to share their tools. They're going to share their techniques with other members of these 256 large network. So, you know, this is a myth, I think, that the darknet is a Wild West. Operating on the darknet probably entails a non-trivial risk of arrest if you're an offender. And this is, you know, the spike in operations indicates that there is capacity being built in police organizations, without listening to the interviews, without analyzing the data, the qualitative data. What also appears is a small number of countries seem to be conducting this type of, driving those operations, driving this regulation and more robust enforcement of activities on the darknet. And some of them, we expected to find them, FBI, DOJ. Europol was a surprise because usually, you know, those European agencies, they are said to be ineffective and to be not so good at being operational. Well, it seems that actually they seem to have a nice, interesting brokerage role in facilitating those operations. But the big surprise was those two smaller countries. Well, Germany is not a small country, but smaller than the US, for example. Two smaller countries having this outstanding, almost as important of a role as a country such as the US. So where does this come from? Big question mark. And to me, a big surprise from studying general cybercrime law enforcement is the smaller role of the private sector and NGOs. So I'll show you something I found in the previous paper, and only people in the room will be able to read the results. But in the previous paper, using the same methodology on general cybercrime collaboration, on closeness centrality, the number one organization was Microsoft. And Symantec was in the top 10 countries, Telefonica from Spain, number 5 as well. So the role of the private sector and international organizations such as Interpol was much bigger. And the same in betweenness centrality, Microsoft was number 1. And number 2 was Save the Children, an NGO. So this NGO had the capacity to bring together a whole range of organizations to collaborate on training, capacity building. But it seems in operational stuff, it's really closed to law enforcement, national agencies, and a handful of private organizations. So maybe something to investigate a bit further. So now the aim is to use that to do qualitative analysis of the interviews, but try to find out some of the reasons why this kind of structure of the network is such as it is, and maybe to get some feedback as well from you guys to identify some mistakes or some discrepancies in our interpretation of the data. So if you have any questions or any comments, I welcome them, and feel free to email me at this address. If you have insults, if you're a law enforcement officer, I completely misunderstood what you're doing, you can also email me. I'll gladly answer to you. So thank you very much. I think Mike has a question, but I don't know, he's a bit shy.
He's a bit shy. Just an interpretation of the Save the Children. I mean, surely this is probably a function of the kind of darknet operations. So, if given the priority attached to child sex abuse online, I don't find that and child trafficking. I don't find it that surprising.
No, my surprise was not about save the children is not in the darknet network. I expected that as well, but I would have expected generally, maybe not NGOs, but at least the private sector, you know, all the Bitcoin tracing and startups trying to make the dark web a bit clearer, not to appear more. That was a bit surprising to me. They have capacity that maybe would have been of value to law enforcement. So either they have NDAs and they don't appear because they don't wish to be mentioned, because their investors don't like it, because they don't want to be attacked. I don't know why. NGOs, I was expecting. The private sector, I'm a bit surprised. Then we can chat at coffee.
Hi, my name is Sesha Ketanini. I have a comment. You just said something like, if the offender wants to move, they can move to a different country to avoid Netherlands, something like that, right? But the Netherlands police and FBI have been very active, and they track down the offender no matter where they go. For example, one of the big darknet sites, person who's in charge actually moved to Thailand, and the FBI and Netherlands police were able to track him down and ask the Thai police to arrest him. And finally, he died in Thai prison. But so even if they escape, they're able to track these offenders. So
just like my lawyer colleagues, I will have a disclaimer, this was not legal advice. But yeah, I get your point, and there are many ways, automated ways to track all those people, even if they're not in their country of residence. And that's actually when the US law enforcement very often arrests them, when they're traveling for leisure.
So they're able to, very effectively able to track these offenders.
Yes. Yeah. Maybe you can go to Russia.
Hi, thank you. My name is Wouter Kleinzoon. I am from the Dutch National Police. Thank you, Benoit, for...
So if you want to ask for a budget increase, I will accept only 0.1% of your increase as a research fund.
I already sent out a picture to my team, and we are very happy with that. So I'm wondering, to what extent do you think the investment of our small country and also Germany is due to infrastructure hosted in these countries? We know that the Netherlands has good infrastructure also to host criminal stuff. We try to get rid of them, but well, it's a challenge, of course. Do you think this influences countries to make a decision whether to invest in cybercrime or darknet markets? To go after it.
So that's a discussion we had yesterday with Yap, and I thought about it during the night. And if it was only because of the hosting landscape, this industry, Canada would be as well positioned as the Netherlands, because Canada has a massive hosting industry, because it's cold, so you don't have to cool down all the servers, and so we are also very welcoming of all the hosting businesses from Europe and from North America. We have a privacy regime that makes it very attractive as well. And still, so if it was only the hosting, maybe it contributes to it, but I'm not sure it's only the hosting. You know, maybe it's a trigger, but if it was a determinant in those investments, I think Canada would rank much higher as well, and it doesn't. So I think that might be part of the reason, but I think there are other reasons. And I would say, for example, a sense of innovativeness in law enforcement organizations. There is a degree of innovation in the Dutch National Police with the high-tech crime unit that doesn't happen in other organizations. I am less familiar with the German police, so it could be part of the explanation. We were talking yesterday about the hiring process, the fact that the Dutch National Police seems to be have an easier time hiring techies that might build a kind of critical mass of people with this kind of way of thinking that then makes some operations possible compared to other law enforcement organizations. So I think that this is where the social network analysis stops and we have to do qualitative analysis.
Thank you.
And I'll stop ruling David's schedule.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to resume the workshop. So this paper, which is still being written at this time, is part of this PMI impact project that I mentioned at the opening of the day. So Benoit is part of the team. Eile, you'll be hearing later from, is also part of the team. And so this is a paper that Camille Faubert and I have been working on for the past few weeks. And the whole team is also going to join us later on in this paper. And this is the result of interviews that we did with law enforcement from all over the world. If you recall, I was, you know, supposed with the rest of the team to travel the world, see new countries and discover new people. And basically, I had to stay in my basement and do some Zoom calls. So it wasn't all that exciting, but I hope the results are going to be exciting. So, I mean, we've had many examples and, you know, we heard this morning about kind of the how the dark web has changed over even just the past few years. I really like in Jap's presentations, just the number of police operations that have happened on the dark web is kind of dizzying. We saw with Benoit that there were over 50 in 2020 alone. So that means that pretty much every single week, some bad guy is being taken down somewhere on the internet, basically. And that wasn't really always the case. I mean, if you go back to the first days of my research on the dark web, I was kind of very innocent and young at that point, and I thought that the dark web would be there forever. And when you heard the interviews that, you know, the offenders were doing with large publications, this is the Silk Road, which was kind of the first big dark web marketplace. He was interviewed by Forbes, so, you know, it's kind of Forbes taking the time to interview dark web marketplace guys. And basically, he just said that, you know, the people on the dark web were above the law. They could do anything they wanted. They could sell guns, drugs, and there was basically no force on earth that could take them down. And so that lasted actually for a couple of years where, you know, they were doing these interviews and actually believed that, you know, they were going to be there forever and they were going to be there for a long time. And I invested a lot of time and energy in monitoring these guys. And then, you know, this happened. And this was actually the takedown from Silk Road, so the first big dark web marketplace. And my partner that I was working with at the time on this research, her name is Judith Aldridge, for those that know her, Silk Road was actually shut down on her birthday. And it was kind of, we were kind of mad because, you know, this was our main research tool that we were monitoring these guys, and it being taken down meant that we had to find somebody else to study. And so that was kind of a big drawback for us in our research. But basically, this operation just showed that it was possible to take down offenders on the dark web. It took years. It took probably millions of dollars. It was a, you know, a long operation. But really, it just showed that it was possible to take these guys down. And as we've heard and seen and understood so far this morning, basically these operations, there was just one in 2013, but these quickly accelerated up to a point where today we have, you know, over 50 per year. And here you have just a few examples of them. And we're seeing bigger and bigger operations with tens of millions of dollars being seized, with hundreds of people being arrested at a time. And so we're seeing these operations that are accelerating, but also increasing in scope. And so the question then becomes, well, you know, is this problem solved? So, you know, is the dark web still an issue? Doing police operations online, is that still a problem? And so if we go into the literature and we look at what people have said, well, they say that, you know, it's not maybe as hard as it used to be, but it's still by no means no easy feat. And I think that Yap's presentation just showed that level of security and the level of sophistication of offenders online is really significant, and you really need to have a police operation and police teams that are equally sophisticated to match that, basically. And so there's a number of challenges that arise from doing these police operations and, you know, targeting online offenders on the dark web. The first thing is just, you know, the lack of clear definition. So basically, you know, what is a cybercrime? And if you teach any cybercrime class, you know, that's a very interesting question. It's like in my social network class, you know, when I ask the students, what does it mean to be friend with someone? And then, you know, the funniest answer I ever got was, well, that's someone who would lend me money. So I thought, okay, that's a weird definition of what a friend is, but okay, I'll take it. But basically, just the fact that there's no coherent or no single definition of cybercrime makes it difficult to say, well, what is a cyber specialist? What is a cybercrime unit? And it makes the whole police operation and the organization of police extremely difficult because it makes a lot of confusion over the roles and responsibilities of people. The second thing is the underreporting and recording issues with cybercrime. I'm not kind of, you know, declaring something that's pretty out there. But basically, most of the victims of cybercrime don't realize that they've been victimized. Many people don't think that it's okay to report these crimes. And when they do, they don't really know whom to report it to. And on the other hand, law enforcement isn't always kind of in tune to receiving these complaints. And, you know, I know we're not in the academic world supposed to give kind of personal examples, but, you know, my mother was an attorney and someone did a fake website with her name, and it was really interesting because it was this immigration law firm, and they had this kind of burning head, like a skeleton head that was on fire, turning on itself, and it was like this Satanist kind of website, and then it said, we're attorney at law, please hire us for your, you know, for to help you with your immigration. And so I don't know who would hire this Satanist firm, you know, for their law problems. But, you know, when she went to the police to report this problem, well, the police said, well, you know, we don't know what we're supposed to do, and we don't know what how we can deal with this problem. So this reporting problem is really people on one end reporting the issues, but also law enforcement receiving this information and making something out of it, which is kind of difficult. At the same time, when we're looking at these issues, we also see that many businesses, for example, don't want to report any victimization because they're afraid they're going to be, you know, put in the newspapers and they're going to have a bad reputation because, you know, they leaked some data or they were victimized, basically. The second set of issues is the legal challenges. So basically here, I think this was touched a bit upon this morning already, but you know, basically the first problem is the lack of substantive law, which means that there's not that many laws targeting cybercrime. Sometimes we feel that there's too many or they're too harsh, but at the same time, this is a problem that's constantly evolving. We're looking, you know, the ransomware problem wasn't there, you know, 8 years ago. So how does law keep up with all these new issues is a very big question, and you don't always have the right laws to fight these problems. The second thing is the lack of procedural law. So basically, how are you supposed to deal with these problems? How are you supposed to conduct your investigations? So are you allowed to, for example, seize a laptop? Are you allowed to search a cell phone? These rules and regulations, they're not in place in all of the countries, and they make it very difficult for law enforcement basically to do their job and to understand what is legal and what is not. And if you're from Quebec, you've seen over the past recent years just how difficult it is to get a conviction in many cases, and you have to buy the right evidence, you have to do the things the right way. And that's something that's very challenging that many people take for granted. And in the case of cybercrime, how do you really deal with this problem is still a very big question. Finally, there's the interjurisdictional issues. So basically, how do you deal with the international nature of cybercrime? When you're doing these police operations, you're probably going to have the victims in one country, you're going to have the computers in a different country that were responsible for the attack, and then the perpetrators in a third country. So how do you deal with all of these countries, all these nations, all these time zones, all these rules and regulations that are going to be different? It's something that's still a very big challenge and something that we haven't solved, basically. Now, the third and last kind of set of challenges is the forensic challenges. So basically, just, you know, taking in the volume and the scope of cybercrime is an incredibly big problem. The number of cybercrime that is out there is just impossible to quantify. And law enforcement don't necessarily have the right expertise. the funding and the tools necessary for these investigations. And, you know, just to give you an example, just in my own office, for example, I don't know how many terabytes of data that I have. And if for some reason, you know, law enforcement had to come and seize my equipment and copy everything, it would probably take them days, and it would be extremely impossible to find anything in there because it's a huge mess of data. And it's just, you know, me, a single researcher. And so when you're looking at these challenges, when you're doing these police operations, it becomes extremely difficult just because of the rules and regulations that maybe are not there to support you. You're not necessarily knowing what's legal and what is not. It's constantly being redefined. And then you don't necessarily have all of the tools and the tradecraft that you're supposed to conduct these police operations. Now, these three challenges, they're not going to play out exactly the same in every cases. So depending on in which country you are, you're going to see very big differences in how they impact your work. So in more totalitarian countries, for example, having the right rules and the right laws on the books may not be as important, just because if you want to get someone convicted, pretty easy thing to do. You just call the judge and you tell him, hey, convict this guy, and you know they're going to get convicted. So depending on which country you're talking about, it's not going to be as important or as challenging. And these limits and challenges, they're not going to be the same also depending on the level of police that you are. If you're at the national level, you're more likely to have more expertise, more prestige, the ability to recruit people, you know, with more talent and more experience. And that's not something that you're going to have more at the local level with law enforcement. So these challenges are going to be, you know, a real problem for some levels of police, but not the others. Lastly, and that's a really big question, and maybe we should do a workshop just on this topic, basically, how important is the private sector, and how does it really help law enforcement? Anecdotally, it was really interesting to hear how law enforcement will receive tips from the private sector, but it's something that we don't always hear about. It's always kind of under the carpet. We don't really know what's going on that front. And so on some countries and for some law enforcement, you're going to see the private sector playing a bigger role, helping out law enforcement. But in other cases, they're going to be actually hindering these police operations, either because they don't want to share information, they don't want to look bad. And so depending on the type of police operation you're going to be doing and who your targets are, you're going to have a very different kind of experience. So this kind of summarizes kind of what we know about, you know, how easy or how hard is it to get a conviction and to do police operations. That was mostly online and on the dark web as well. And so the goal of this study was basically to try and understand, well, all these findings that were accumulated over the last 20 years, are they still important? Are they still relevant? Is that, you know, still a thing? And trying to understand exactly what are the challenges that law enforcement themselves are telling us are important. And so what we did with the help of the whole team, so Eileen over here, Benoit as well, really contributed to this and to help us do these interviews. And basically, we did interviews with law enforcement officers. This was a totally convenient sample. So basically, we tried to contact all the law enforcement agencies we knew all over the world. And we called them up and say, hey, do you want to talk with us? And some said no. Some said, sure, I'll just get it through my boss. And then we don't hear back from them for 8 months. And then they come back to us. So it was extremely complicated to get the official approval of police organizations to do these interviews. And, you know, being faced in the face of deadlines and, you know, we have to do something, there's a workshop coming after all, we decided that, you know, we were just gonna use LinkedIn. And we went on LinkedIn, and I wanna thank all the law enforcement officers who have a LinkedIn page. And we spammed, I don't know, hundreds or thousands of them, and just said, hey, I'm doing a research project, you wanna talk with me? And basically, this was really eye-opening, and for everyone who wants to do research with law enforcement, apparently it's a really cool tool to use. It worked pretty well, we got lots of responses, and we actually managed to do this project because of LinkedIn. So they're not the sponsor, but you know, we can always thank them for helping us out with this project. The thing that we did is, everyone that we talked with, we basically asked them, you don't have to give me names or like specifics, but talk to me about a police operation that you were involved in, and tell me everything you can about this police operation. You know, how did it start? Did you get a tip? Did you see someone and you wanted to investigate him? How did it all start? How did it evolve over time? What were your goals? What were your aims? What were your resources? Who was involved? How was this operation organized and structured? Who was the boss? Who did you have to report to? And in the end, you know, what happened? And did you think that it was successful or not? And that was a really interesting question when we were asking law enforcement, you know, was this a success? Either it's because people really believe that they were successful, but I'm not sure if anyone said that they were not successful. Everyone is just happy with everything they do, and they were really proud of all their police operations. But basically, it seems like all police operations have a nice ending. So, you know, that's kind of nice to hear, basically. So this is descriptive statistics of what we had. So we had 46 hours of interviews between March 2020 and September 2021. You have the countries that we interviewed law enforcement from. We have a mix of women and men. We did have an educated sample of law enforcement, so 75% had college degrees, so that was pretty high. The mean age, so we really were happy. Of course, if you're going to draw from LinkedIn, you're going to have maybe an older crowd. I don't know how many 20-something have LinkedIn profiles, but it ranged from 25 to 60 years old. The average was 20 years of experience on law enforcement, and that's something that was really happy. So we had people with vast experience in law enforcement. And we had all degrees, so national, regional, local agencies, even international agencies. You guys can figure out kind of where these people worked. And most of them were still working for law enforcement, and that was also something that was interesting. So to hear from people who were in law enforcement and are not there anymore kind of have a different point of view, and provided us with even more rich data set, basically. So we took an inductive approach. So basically, we just did all the interviews, and we tried to find, okay, so can we find some teams and sub-teams that were discussed in the interviews, and try all of this around kind of what are the challenges that the law enforcement officers met. So some of these interviews were not taped, so that's why we don't have more hours than that were taped. Many law enforcement were kind of reticent to have, you know, their video on Zoom being recorded, and we can totally understand that, but we had even more data just from the notes that we took in. And so basically what I'm presenting today is kind of the first analysis that we did. Moving forward, there's a lot more that we actually want to do and can do, but basically you're gonna see that this is kind of in order the main challenges that were discussed in the interviews. So the biggest constraint on these police operations on the dark web was really around the lack of resources and the high workload of law enforcement officers in the case of these operations. So basically, kind of one of the biggest problem that they faced was the fact that there was not that much money for training. And in many cases, you know, if you know what Excel is, they will just put you in the cybercrime team and say, hey, you know about computers, so you go and figure it out. And so there was very little funding that was, you know, provided to people. And even, you know, when there was training available, there was just, you know, not enough time to do it. So it's always a problem that we've seen in many organizations is, hey, you can have a 1 week training, but you have to finish all your workload before you can take the training. And that happens when you retire, basically. And so that was kind of a big complaint about, well, you know, I'm in this job, but I don't even know what I'm doing here, basically. The second thing, and it goes along with this, was the fact that, you know, many of these cybercrime units are actually understaffed, and, you know, they don't have actually the time to do whatever they want. And that's actually an interesting question that we can talk about, and Yap kind of mentioned this, is how when you do one police operation, you take all this evidence that you gather and leads on to other police investigations. But then the question becomes, well, you could have 200 police operations coming out of an operation like Hansa Market, but actually how many of these operations are going to be put into place? Only a handful, just because everyone is overworked and the units are understaffed. The other thing, and that's something we've seen, you know, in many cases, people complaining about the competition with the private industry. So basically, you know, it's exactly the same as with the military. you go in the military or the law enforcement, you know nothing about computer forensic science or, you know, all these stuff. You work there for a couple of years, you know, you come out and you're being great at your job, and what happens? You're gonna have a private firm come in, say, I'll pay you triple your salary if you come and work with me. And basically that's what people do. And that's what we see with the Air Force and many other divisions, you know, in the government. So basically, these law enforcement agencies, all of their best assets are being stolen, and there's very few people who decide to stay in law enforcement when you see the conditions that you could have, you know, money-wise, and the quality of life that you're gonna get in the private sector compared to the police operations. It's clear that you're gonna move to the private sector. So that was kind of by far the biggest challenge that law enforcement faced. The second thing was, you know, international relations, kind of how you deal with, you know, these uncooperative countries. And Benoit this morning was talking about, you know, the countries who are most involved in police operations on the dark web. And, you know, there were just two big countries that were not mentioned, China and Russia. And how do you deal with these countries? Are they helping? We saw recently with the ransomware groups that attacked, you know, the critical infrastructure of the United States, where maybe Russia decided that, okay, guys, you went really too far, you have to scale back now. But there's still a lot of problems and questions and a lot of frustration because you know exactly who the person is, but you just can't get access to them, and that seemed to be a pretty big frustration. Another big problem with these international relations was the problem with the legal frameworks that are gonna be very different from country to country. So even if me, let's say I was a law enforcement officer in Canada, and I have this amazing evidence on Eileen, I know, you know, she's done something really bad. Well, if I send it to someone in the Netherlands or the United States, maybe the evidence that I have is not admissible, maybe it's not formatted in the right way, maybe you don't have the right chain of custody. And so it becomes extremely difficult to deal with all these legal frameworks. And how do you deal with, you know, even the consequences? So am I going to send evidence to someone in the United States, which could lead to the death penalty for someone who would be accused with this information? These are really big, important questions that law enforcement have, and that stops them from sharing all the evidence that they would like to. Then there's the weak relationships with industry. I mean, in cybersecurity, private companies, they know so much, they have so much evidence. Their analysts, they do a lot of stuff that is either gray or white hat, but there's a lot of information, and yet the police doesn't really cooperate that much with the private sector. And that was a point that was really interesting because that's what people would say officially, was that there was a lot of limitations between what law enforcement could actually do with the private sector. And one of the problem is the fact that, you know, law enforcement wants to receive tips from the private sector, but they can't really share back information to the private sector. And it becomes this one-way communication, which doesn't really encourage people from the private sector to share just because, well, they give a lot, but they don't receive anything in return, and then becomes kind of a frustration in that point. And even to some extent, the private companies don't really want to support or want to give out data just because their goal is to protect, you know, their customers' privacy, and they don't want to get involved into all these police operations. So there was a lot of, you know, suspicion between law enforcement and private sector that was described. Lastly, the last challenge that was presented was about the dark web. That's also a big question about, you know, how much of an issue is the dark web today. So Yap, you know, talked about the anonymity and the encryption. And then the question becomes, well, is that still relevant? So if there's someone using, you know, the Tor network, how difficult is it really today to find who that person is? And will encryption really protect the offenders? And that's one point we could talk about in the roundtable later on today, but all the law enforcement I've ever spoken to have told me that whenever we arrest someone, they always give us the passwords to their encrypted drive, and if they don't, we'll find a way to convince them it's in their best interest to give us this password. And so many were talking about kind of the encryption being a problem, but at the same time, maybe not that much. The main problem was the length of these investigations. And so how when you're doing these investigations online on the dark web, they can go on for years, and basically it doesn't really match up with the investigations that their bosses wanted them to do, which means, you know, we want to have quick arrests, we want to move pretty quickly. And this kind of led them to believe that they were actually only going after the low-hanging fruit instead of going after the sophisticated actors, and they had a feeling that they were actually targeting maybe not the most sophisticated or the most powerful actors on the dark web. And so this is something we could also discuss, but basically kind of this limitation in their expertise and the time that they have and the resources goes back to the first challenge and saying, are we really targeting the right people? And so kind of moving forward, what you know, law enforcement were sharing with us is basically, so what do we do with all this and with all these challenges, basically? One of the things that many, especially at the local and regional level, what they wanted was to have more cooperation. So basically to say, well, when I have a case, when I have an issue, I need to have someone on hand that I can call to support me. It can be even, you know, as easy as having someone who has, you know, cryptocurrency tracking software, and they can just put in a wallet and they can see where the money is coming from, where it's going to. Having access to these technologies and these collaborations appeared to be something that would really increase the level of police operations. The second thing was to see, well, how can we all work within the same legal framework? We know just in the EU how difficult it is to get anything adopted, and then having something that would be global would be even more orders of magnitude harder. But basically having ways to share evidence and making sure that this evidence can be used in other countries and accepted by other countries is something that was a huge problem. And if we could solve that, according to the law enforcement officers, that would be something that would be incredibly useful. And finally, this was something that was that kind of boggled the minds of pretty much everyone we talked with when we said, you know, do you measure the success of your operations? How do you know if you were successful, how successful you were, and what is the basis of this? That's something that everyone told us, we don't have time for this. This is not something that we do. It's just, you know, we arrested people. Isn't that good enough? And, you know, many of them, we saw that they were thinking a bit more about, well, how can we actually get metrics on how successful we were? How can we measure this? And how can we, you know, kind of plot over time, are we doing something that's actually good, or are we just turning in circles, basically? And so moving forward, there's many ways that we could be doing this, you know, looking at have we disrupted the activities, you know, how many victims have we rescued in the case of child sex exploitation, kind of the intelligence that we've gathered. And so there's many ways of measuring success, there's just not only one, and that's something that needs to be discussed. So basically, that is the summary of over a year and a half of work talking with law enforcement. And we do have, I think, just 2 minutes for questions. So if there's a question from the audience, I would be happy to answer it. And if not, we have our next speakers as me around. And thank you for your attention.
Question, comment, insult? No.
If not, David, if you want to know.
To be like looking at people as opposed to looking at a screen. Do you know what I mean? I'm sure everyone's feeling. Lately, most meetings have been not in person, which is works to some degree, but doesn't work in others. So it's nice to be here. So I thought, in a way, most of you know a hell of a lot more about this subject than I do. So let me start out with the following. I'm going to start out with a story, actually, I thought about on the way here. A number of years ago, I was in Washington and at a meeting on white-collar crime, and a federal judge and I were sitting talking, and he told me the following story. He said, it was about Oliver Wendell Holmes, who was a justice of the Supreme Court. If you've ever seen pictures of him, he's very distinguished looking, distinctive looking with a beard and stuff like this. You wouldn't miss him. He's in the papers a lot. But anyway, he was on a train leaving Washington, and the conductor came up to him and said, sir, can I have your ticket? And Holmes started looking here and there in his briefcase, and he had a reputation for forgetfulness. And at that point, the conductor recognized him, and he said, "Oh, Mr. Holmes, don't worry. Just send the ticket into the company afterwards. It's fine." And Holmes is supposed to have looked up to him very sternly and said, "The problem is not where is my ticket. The problem is where am I going?" Right? So here's the problem for me. Where am I going? So here's what I want to do today. I want to tell you a bit about my work on places. Right? In particular, I'm going to talk about the law of crime concentration. And then once I go through that a bit, and one of the reasons I'm doing that, many of you may not know of this work, you're not necessarily in the same area, I'm going to ask whether that work has relevance for understanding internet crime, or whether it should have relevance. So that's where I'm going. So let me just start out by saying that my kind of criminology, many people today see me as sort of like a mainstream criminologist, well-recognized, et cetera, but when I began my work, criminology was about, you know, who done it, right? That's what criminologists did. Why do people commit crime? And from the beginning of my career, and I'll talk about it in a minute, that's not what I was really interested in. And I was interested in the question of where done it. These birds, I always use this. Someone actually asked my permission to use this slide. It's not absolutely my slide, whatever, but I use it so often. About these birds, location, location, location. And so my work has surrounded or been focused upon the idea of place and crime. Now, I just want to say that for those of you criminologists, this is not the way criminologists normally think about place. When criminologists think about place, traditionally, they thought about large areas. This is a slide from Thrasher on the book The Gang. And you can see the slum territories. This is Chicago, by the way, on here, on the screen. The slum was this large area in the middle of the city. So in criminology, traditionally, people have focused on sort of macro geographic areas. But that wasn't my interest, and the interest of a number of other people that began to work in this a bit ago. Here you see on the left-hand side of the screen a street segment. I do a lot of work on street segments, intersection to intersection. I believe they have a kind of social life of their own. They're easy for cops to figure out where it is between that street and that street. But the point is, these are microgeographic areas, not meso or macrogeographic areas of criminologists have usually thought about it. On the right side is from a study I did in Jersey City that I'll talk about in a few minutes. And that's a prostitution hotspot, and it's a cluster of streets, right? So again, a bunch of streets, not as small as the street segment, but still much, much smaller than the traditional focus. These are the microgeographic hotspots of crime. So this all began for me when I was finishing my PhD, and I was starving and needed to get a real job for a bit. And I went to the Vera Institute in New York City, and they gave me this responsibility of leading a project which was evaluating the first really community policing program in New York City. And if you look, this was in a place, it was kind of run down. If you look in the right of the screen, there's a picture from the time. A lot of streets were worse than that. On the left-hand side, you see a group of beats. Each beat had an officer. This was a community policing program, an innovation at the time. Each beat would have an officer walking the beat. And my job for a year before I finished my PhD was to walk the street with these cops. And to be frank, I learned more in that year than I have for the rest of my career with these guys about crime, how they respond to crime, etc. But I also learned something else. And I'm going to use Malcolm Gladwell in his book, Talking to Strangers, talks about my experiences. Because it's relevant to what he's trying to write about. Let me see if I can actually get this right. Oh, this is bad.
In fact, okay. The majority text in which the stranger is operating.
Okay, I think that's right. Can you hear this?
Brooklyn's 72nd Precinct covers the neighborhoods surrounding Greenwood Cemetery, from Prospect Expressway in the north to Bay Ridge in the south. In the narrow strip between the western perimeter of the cemetery and the waterfront, a series of streets run downhill towards the water. A crumbling, elevated freeway meanders down the middle. Today, it is a gentrifying neighborhood. It was not 30 years ago, when David Weisburd spent a year walking up and down those streets. Weisburd was a criminologist by training. He had done his dissertation at Yale University on violent behavior among settlers in the West Bank and Israel. He was born in Brooklyn. After leaving Yale, he got a job working on a research project back in his old borough. The study was based out of the precinct house on Fourth Avenue. There were 9 officers involved. each assigned to a beat of 10 to 30 blocks.
And their job is to walk around those beat areas and to interact with the public and to...
But I was going to comment that he interviewed
them. They got to know these.
And he didn't ask my permission.
We spent a long time in one of these streets. Where it's a bad neighbor to town, most of the streets didn't have any crime.
He didn't understand it. Criminals were people who operated outside social constraint. They were driven by their own dark impulses, mental illness, greed, despair, anger. Weisburd had been taught that the best way to understand why criminals did what they did was to understand who they were.
I call it the Dracula model. Most criminologists would not like the term Dracula model, but that's what I call it. Because it's a model about people driven to crime that says that people are so highly motivated to commit crime, nothing else really matters.
Yet if criminals were like Dracula, driven by an insatiable desire to create mayhem, they should have been roaming throughout the 72nd precinct. The kinds of social conditions that Draculas feed on were everywhere. But the Draculas weren't everywhere. They were only on a single block, a street segment. It was that specific. Didn't criminals have legs? Subway tokens? Like most other criminologists, Weisburd had been studying people. He started to think maybe he ought to be more concerned with places.
Okay. So, yeah, I thought that Gladwell has it right, and how I began all this, which is interesting, right? That I began my career of work walking the street with cops and sort of, like David, talking to them, et cetera, right? Starting to think about the way the world worked differently. So in this study, what I began to think was that place was an extremely important issue. Though these areas were about 20 square blocks, they were bad neighborhoods, we spent all our time on one or two street segments. And thus begins my interest in this area. Now, the key to all this is the law of crime concentration. And I think it's the key in terms of understanding prevention, place-based prevention, and perhaps thinking about the issue of whether this is relevant to the internet. So again, things happen, you know, sort of moment when you look at your research and you say, wow, well, I didn't expect that. So this is a crime in Seattle, Washington, crime incidents from 1989 to 2004. And I want you to notice the blue line. The blue line is the percent of crime producing, the percent of streets producing 50% of crime. And what, now, we've known for a long time, early, I'll talk about the study later, 20 years earlier, 15 years earlier, we knew that crime was concentrated at a relatively small number of places. But this sort of surprised me, which is every single year in Seattle, crime was concentrated at about the same level. About 5% of the streets produced 50% of the crime, right? That was sort of a moment for me when I began to think, wait a minute, there's something going on here. It's not just that you tend to have more crime in certain places. By the way, that's common in almost every field, in economics and business, even in computer chips, a very small number of processors produce most of the processing. But here it is, you have the same level of crime each year. And then, at the same time, I was doing some work in, and I wish I had a pointer here, you could still hear me when I'm here, but they can't hear me probably on the internet. But if you look in the left, here is from an earlier article I wrote with Cynthia Lum and Sean Bushway and Suming Yang, the 50% of the crime level, right? So that's stability, right? By the way, 1% of the streets produce 25% of the crime. But if you look at the right, this is from an article I wrote with someone in Israel, and that's Tel Aviv. So Seattle and Tel Aviv, in both cities, 5% of the places produce 50% of the crime. That's really interesting. If you've been to Seattle and you've been to Tel Aviv, these are not similar cities, neither in terms of the kind of people who live there, for the most part, but also in terms of geography, everything you can think of. They are cosmopolitan cities, but Tel Aviv would be more like New York, perhaps, than like Seattle. But again, you have this tremendous, this consistency. And then for my Sutherland lecture at the ASC a few years ago, I looked at a bunch of cities and said, well, what's happening? And here you have Sacramento, Seattle, New York, Tel Aviv, and Cincinnati. And though there's variability, it's not all 5%. Indeed, when we cleaned up the data, Seattle was still 5.1%. But it's from about 4.2 to 6%. So there's what I began to call a law of crime concentration. It's not just that crime is concentrated. It's concentrated at a pretty similar level, amazingly similar level, if you ask me. I mean, when I saw this the first time, started seeing this, Seattle and Tel Aviv, I said, oh my God, wow, that's kind of amazing. So there's a concentration level, and this has been now replicated in city after city after city. The only time this changes is when you use different metrics, but when you look at the percent of crime, the percent of streets are producing 50% of the crime, you get about this 5% figure all the time. By the way, you get about 1% for 25% of crime. So the point I want to make here is that this provides a kind of underlying logic for prevention. Because if most crime is concentrated, at least a great amount of crime, if you go to 1% of the streets and get 25% of the crime, you probably should be concentrating there. By the way, about 60%, between 45 and 60% of streets have no crime at all in most cities. So you shouldn't be sending police to those sorts of places. That's what Gladwell picked up on, by the way. The logic model is that you should be focusing on those places that have a lot of crime. That's an efficient way to do policing. And there's an important issue here. And that issue is that, well, you could say, if I do that, what's going to happen is I'm going to focus on those places, right? You have places in cities. In Baltimore, you have places with 500, 1,000 crime events. And if I'm going to focus on that place, what's going to happen? Well, crime is just going to move around the corner, right? In other words, that's not going to help me with prevention. And that was a sort of impediment to prevention from the very beginning. This is from Seattle. This is a group-based trajectory analysis. It asks the question, are there different groups of streets with a similar pattern, right? And what you can see here is that group on the top, that's the 1% of streets basically producing 25% of crime. And those streets are hot pretty much year to year. Now, do all those streets stay hot? No. Are there streets that become hot that weren't hot? Yes. But the amazing thing here is this tremendous consistency. Pretty much the same streets that are high in 1989 Seattle are high in 2002. And there's good reason. If you start thinking about it, it shouldn't be surprising to you. Like we did a study of juvenile offending, and we asked where the incidents were for the hotspots, if you like. So groups 6, 7, 8 were the hotspots, and this was for juvenile crime. And as you can see, where are they? Shops, malls, and restaurants, and youth centers. Well, that's not surprising. That's where the kids are, right? I mean, why is crime occurring in those places? Because those are the activity places for young people. It's not occurring at bars. Look at bars. For most crime, around the bars, you'd have, you know, hot spots of crime. But here, with juveniles, what you have is it occurring in the places where they're hanging out, where they may be getting a bus to school, where they may be hanging out at a shopping center or other places, playing with friends or going into stores that have games and things of this sort. We did a study in Seattle in which we looked at the 16 years of data I just said. We tried to identify what were the important features that seemed to explain why there were hotspots of crime. What explains one place being a hotspot versus another? We found the number of employees there. It makes sense. If you have people on the block working, they may be leaving, they're leaving their cars. Think of all the opportunities for crime that's creating. The number of residents. In other words, more people on the street, you have more potential for crime. Not surprising. High-risk juveniles. Well, our view is that if you have high-risk juveniles in the street, they often attract other people that might be problematic, even if they're not committing the crime. Property values. Higher property values, lower crime rates. Physical disorder, a big effect. More physical disorder, more crime. If it's an arterial road, you're about 10 times more likely to be a hotspot. Now, these are not surprising to you. If I asked you, you'd probably tell me these things. But the point here, the crime is coupled to place. That there are features of these places that make it attractive to crime. And that, by the way, as I'm going to talk about in a minute, suggests that you won't simply have displacement. Because if there are reasons they're there, right, they have to go to another place that has those attractive situations, right? If you have a lot of juvenile crime at a mall, it's not going to displace to the single-family homes that might be in the next few blocks. So the idea of displacement becomes less concerning. So we have a law of crime concentration, and we have the idea that crime is coupled to place. So let me talk a minute. You guys are interested in prevention, right? So this work has led to a lot of prevention ideas. So let me start out with something historical. Most people here are a bit younger, and you've grown up at a time when we all believed that the police can prevent crime, that works, etc. But when I started my career, this is what was out there. The police do not prevent crime. This is one of the best-kept secrets of modern life. Experts know it, the police know it, but the public does not know it. Yet the police pretend that they are society's best defense against crime. This is a myth. That was David Bailey, the most important police scholar of the 1990s. No evidence exists that augmentation of police forces or equipment, differential patrol strategies, or differential intensities of surveillance have an effect on crime rates. That's where I began my career. You might say it was kind of not a smart career move to begin your career looking at prevention when Gottfried and Hershey and Bailey and these other people are saying prevention can't work. Well, I don't know. I was very persistent. And to be frank, back to the 72nd precinct, I walked around with these guys. They worked on specific crimes, on specific blocks, and it looked to me like the crime was going down in those blocks. So I said, no, something's wrong here. And that led, Larry Sherman and I ended up in the same place at Rutgers University for a year, and we sat together, and he had just done some work in Minneapolis on crime concentrations, and we said to each other, you know what, it's not that the police can't be effective against crime, it's that they're allocating themselves incorrectly. If they would allocate themselves to the hotspots of crime instead of wasting their time all over the place, we'd get a crime prevention benefit. Now, that was our theory. As I said, it might not have been smart. It turned out to be smart, by the way. Like, it turned out that way, I don't know. I spoke to someone before and they said, you pick an advisor, you pick the wrong advisor or the right advisor, you never know exactly what's going to happen next. But we began with this idea that we were young Turks and we thought this principle, the police could not prevent crime, was wrong. The problem is they weren't using what I eventually began to call the law of crime concentration. Okay, so this led us to the Minneapolis hotspots experiments. It's one of the first big randomized trials in policing. We wanted to look at whether this hotspots idea could work. We identified 110 crime hotspots of about a street in length, a street segment in length, allocated to treatment and controlled conditions. The treatment sites were supposed to, indeed did, get 2 to 3 times the preventive patrol's control site. So what did we do? We took the police force in Minneapolis, it's not easy to do, and whenever they weren't responding to a call, we sent them to these hotspots. Okay, that was the treatment, and for most of this experiment, it led to the amount of dosage we wanted. Here's just a simple graphic. You can see until July, from December to July, there's about a 20% reduction in crimes when you compare the treatment year to the control year. So, yeah, crime prevention, significant crime prevention. This was a very big finding. We published it in 1995. I don't know if asking questions is good. Can you guess why in the summer, everything fell apart? Anybody with an idea why in the summer everything? What happens in the summer? Well, first of all, you're from Montreal. In the summer, it's warm. Minneapolis is also a cold city, so the kids are out and they're making noise. And who wants to go on vacation in the summer? The police want to go on vacation. So we couldn't get dosage, basically. But for the period of which we had dosage, the experiment prevented crime. And this is not alone now. Anthony Braga did a systematic review for the Campbell Collaboration. You can see, you know, this is a forest plot. That middle line is doesn't work, zero. To the right of the line is crime prevention, and to the left is a backfire effect. And as you can see, the studies, there are, I think, of the 70, something like 60 that are significant prevention benefits. So this is not just my study. We now know that if you focus in on crime hotspots, you can have a prevention effect. On the bottom is that little triangle, is the overall significance of prevention for hotspot studies. So there's lots of good evidence. But again, we come to the problem, well, maybe they reduce crime at the hotspots, but crime just moved around the corner. And I'd like to try this again, and hopefully the problem here is that it's very small and I can't tell
you. Father, times someone asked, the two of them would run the numbers. And place they looked, you have to ask yourself where and when you're confronting a stranger. Because those two things powerfully influence your interpretation of who the stranger is. Weisburd has a map that I think makes this point even more powerfully. It's from Jersey City, just across the Hudson River from Manhattan. The triangular dark area in the middle is a prostitution hotspot. A few years ago, Weisburd conducted an experiment in which he assigned 10 extra police officers to patrol those few blocks. Not surprisingly, the amount of prostitution in the area fell by 2/3. When the police cracked down, didn't the sex workers simply move one or two streets over? Weisburd had trained observers stationed in the area talking to the sex workers. Was there displacement? It was not. It turns out that most would rather try something else, leave the field entirely, change their behavior, then shift their location. They weren't just coupled to place, they were anchored to place.
Okay, so, yeah, I really like the way Gladwell tells that. You know, when he wrote this book and did that podcast, I said, boy, I wish I could tell my story quite as well as he does, right? He's a great storyteller if you read his work. But anyway, his point is, this is the Jersey City displacement and diffusion study. And yeah, it was like, you know, these people weren't just coupled to place, they were anchored to place. And this is, these are the two sites we looked at. The middle is the target area. That's where the crime was focused. There was a catchment area, or catchment area one around, and catchment area two. Right? And we did prostitution drugs, we actually did property crime, but it got all messed up, that part of the study. And here are the basic results, right? These are from systematic social observations. So as you can see, before the treatment, right, you have about an average of 3 events per time period that we looked at. I think it was like 40 minutes. And then we have the treatment for prostitution. It goes way down. The blue line is the treatment site for drugs. It continues to decline. But as expected, the prevention program at the hotspots produced a reduction in crime, right? But here's the interesting thing. The red is the catchment area one, and the green is the catchment area two, and those also went down. Now, if the model was correct, that if I clamp down on those places, right, if I clamp down on those places and crime just moves around the corner, then what should have happened is when the hotspot went down, the catchment area should have gone up, but they didn't. They followed the same pattern. And that's what we call diffusion of crime prevention benefits. And again, this is not just my study. This is also from Braga's systematic review. And as you can see, he looked at whether there was diffusion, in other words, the places around, nearby, got better. And when you focused in on hotspots, and the left side you have displacement. There's very little displacement, evidence of displacement, and there's significant across the studies evidence of diffusion. So here you have it, that the law of crime concentration says focus in on that small group of places, we have most of the problems. The data suggest that crime is coupled to place, in other words, it's not so easy as you would think to move around. As Gladwell said, they're like completely attached to those places. And we also have a lot of evidence that that's what's happening. You don't have much displacement. Now, I just want to comment. So, you know, I've already said this, but just to harp on it, so to speak, what are the reasons for this resistance to spatial displacement? By the way, this doesn't mean you'll never get spatial displacement. When cops go to a place and they tell the prostitutes, move to the next street and I won't bother you, you'll get spatial displacement. That's not a very smart prevention effort. That's just a moving effort. But the evidence is that if you do some smart prevention, hotspots policing with some thought, if you like, that you will end up not only reducing crime at the hotspots, but reducing crime in the areas nearby. That's the overall evidence. So why does that happen? Well, one is crime is coupled to place, and what I said before, there are reasons why crime is occurring on that street. Not every other street has those opportunities. If they do, by the way, then you're more likely to have displacement. But the point is that because crime is occurring at places with special opportunity structures, special social situations, etc., that means that when you crack down those places, unless places nearby are exactly the same, you won't have displacement. Now, even if they are similar, you might not have displacement anywhere. And that's because of, let's call it, the psychology of what's going on. In the study, we also interviewed people. I think interviews give you a lot of flavor and a lot of sense of what's going on, about the mechanisms, at least. But anyway, we interviewed people, and what did we find? People would say, drug dealers say at the hotspots, they say, look, you know, we don't move around because, you know, another place that's good for this kind of stuff is over there, but there are already guys there, and if I go there, they're going to shoot me, right? In other words, it's dangerous to move. Other people might already be there, and they won't like you intruding on their territory. On the other hand, going to a place that you don't know, that you're not familiar with, is dangerous and problematic. That occurs for us all. When you move universities, when you move places where you work, when you move places where you live, at the beginning, you're kind of like trying to figure out the landscape, right? It can be very confusing. Well, for these people, what happens is that other places they go to, they don't know who the good guys and the bad guys are. The good guys, from their perspective, are the people who don't call the police. The bad guys are the people who do call the police. So they don't know who they can trust, who they can, etc. So moving places to unfamiliar places is very difficult. You know, one of the most moving things that came out of these interviews is one prostitute was being interviewed, and the interview, wrongly, because we weren't supposed to do that, said to her, you know, there's a prostitution hotspot just like 3 blocks away. Why don't you just go there, right? And she said, those are not my type of girls. I don't feel comfortable there. So many of the things that cause your resistance to move for offenders also relates to whether they move or not. Okay, so after all of this, and this was to give you a sense of this work more generally, both in 2004 and 2018, the National Academy of Sciences concluded that hotspots policing was an effective prevention strategy. Okay, so it's not only a Campbell review, you also have panels of the National Academy of Sciences. And I should say, I chaired the panel in 2018, but it was 17 people besides me, and I was on the panel in 2004. Okay, but here's your, so I appreciate you listening to me and my story and what this is about, but now the question becomes, how is this relevant to you? I mean, what does this have to do with the internet and internet crime? So the first question really is, can we capitalize on the law of crime concentration on the internet? In the physical world, as I've already showed you, the law of crime concentration provides a logic model for how you ought to be approaching the crime problem. You ought to be focusing on those places that have a lot of problems, on those hotspots in the city. And if crime occurs at a small number of places, well, this is an efficient and effective way, or efficient, you can see where it's effective way to work. So the first question is whether crime is concentrated at specific places on the internet. And as this guy suggests, we don't really know much about that, actually. There are a few studies. Sadelbaum and Tilly, for example, examined romance fraud patterns on dating websites. They used data from the National Fraud Intelligence Bureau. They found that 14% of the websites examined account for 78% of all reported incidents. Now, that suggests concentration. But remember, they don't know what the denominator is, right? So they're saying, of the places that have at least one fraud, right, what are they responsible for? That's different than asking what proportion of all the potential websites have fraud, right? It's one of the problems of you're going to run into in this area. So there are two types of questions you can ask. One is, what proportion of crime is produced by those places that have any crime? And that's what you have here. And what I've generally done is, what proportion of crime is produced by what proportion of streets produce, let's say, 50% of the crime. The problem there is that it's easier to figure out how many streets there are in a city than how many websites there are, et cetera. And a PhD student of mine doing work in this area, Aiden, is sitting over there, and she can tell you how difficult this is to try to do. At the same time, I have to say, a lot of people are arguing that the logic model for place-based prevention is here. First of all, in almost every place you look, there is a concentration. Some people call it the Pareto principle. About 20% of factories, for example, produce 80% of the crime. So we would expect it to be here. But it's not only that. It's also that many of the features that couple crime to place would couple crime to cyberspaces. Now, Eden has done some work. She's doing an interesting PhD dissertation on cyber grooming, in which she set up honeypots on certain websites to see what the rates of these actions would be. And remember, again, we don't have the denominator. She chose these websites because they were places where you would tend to find this. But of these places, she finds that 11 chat rooms, one chat room, excuse me, produced 50% of the online grooming events she's collected so far. So this concentration idea, like one chat room, and this is not the question of all the rooms in the world, this is the one she chose, of the 11 she chose, one is responsible for 50% of the events. So I've already mentioned this, but yeah, this makes sense, doesn't it? Because opportunity and social disorganization would seem to me the two things that are important to understanding why crime is coupled to the place. It's directly relevant to internet crime. Francis Bacon said this. I thought originally that Ron Clark and Marcus Felsen said this, but it was Francis Bacon said, opportunity makes a thief, okay? But there are specific websites, right? Eden found a specific group of websites that she thought that cyber grooming would happen at. So what that means is we think there are certain websites with characteristics that make them places where cyber grooming would occur. I think this would occur in a whole series of areas. You ask yourself about the websites, the kind of people that use them, etc. Now, the kind of people that use them relates to another issue, which websites, chat rooms, etc., have social environments. Some of them have a little more control. People react when they see something that looks wrong. Others have no controls or very little controls. Some are child-friendly, some are not, etc. So the nature of these environments, the nature of the people there also has an effect. Now, one of the problems here, so I guess my point is, it strikes me that a law of crime concentration is going to apply to cybercrime. Excuse me. All right. Now, if we think about places, and I think I'm still good, David, right? Another 10 minutes? Okay. So when we think about places, one of the things that made it possible to study places, besides mapping software, was that the police department collected data at the place level. In other words, a field that was very important is where was it? First of all, they have to send the police cars there. So automatically, in management information systems, you get an address, right? And for crime incidents, you then link those addresses. So for place-based criminology, in physical space, there's a great advantage because we have data systems being collected. But that's not happening as far as we can see. And maybe you know differently. You can comment after I talk in regard to cyber problems. Eden again. Eden's right there. Raise your hands, Eden. There you go. You can say hi to her afterwards. Eden was going to originally do her PhD with the UK police, who wanted to find out, who wanted to explore this idea of concentration of cyber grooming in the UK on certain sites. And they promised they would have the data, and they were going to do this and that. And in the end, it was useless. It's just not in policing for places. It's a routine part of management information systems developed by Motorola and all these companies. But this type of thing is still new. So if you want to move in this area, you'll have to work with the police for how they collect the data in a way that makes it possible for you both to see whether there is a law of crime concentration and also what are the characteristics of those places that are more problematic. Now, of course, you're also dealing with the dark web, where people don't go on the dark web if they want to be nice. But even the dark web, I suspect that certain places have a large majority of the events that are extremely problematic. And let's go to displacement diffusion. One of the important discoveries that I've just talked about that allowed us to conduct place-based prevention was to find out that when you focused in on a place, a crime just didn't displace. It was good theory for that, but we were able to show that there isn't displacement. In fact, there's often diffusion. The internet, of course, presents a series of new problems, right? Different from physical places. So beam me up, Scotty. The experience I've had with this is with agent-based modeling. I don't know if anybody else here does agent-based modeling, but in agent-based modeling, it's very hard to have people like walking. So you beam them up. You have them beam from hotspot to hotspot, from street to street. So I have to say that the idea of the internet, where distance is a completely different issue, is not necessarily all that different. In other words, this idea, what's different in the internet? If you're in a street, you have to walk to the next street, take 10 minutes to go to the street afterwards. In the internet, every place is in the same place in one level, right? Because you can get from place to place, it doesn't matter. There is no physical space between them. But already in agent-based modeling, we're already doing that. So that idea of having sort of a beam up, in other words, just move from place to place, is something that is already there, and we can think about it and apply it, I think, to internet crime. But at the same time, for a while, we've known that there have been different sort of places. For example, there was an interesting study done in the UK looking at offenders fleeing, I believe terrorists or something, and when they started generating distance, they didn't use physical distance, because people are going on the underground. So if the underground goes with express to a spot, that could take 5 minutes. If it's a local, it could take 15 minutes. And if it doesn't stop there, you have to get out, walk out, and get to that place. So this idea that there are different, distance is different than we normally think of in physical space, is already occurring in the crime and place literature, and it hasn't offset many of the findings. And I think the bottom line is that the same issues that explain or help us understand the mechanisms of why you don't have displacement in physical space can help you in cyberspace. For example, there are likely a limited number of places that have similar opportunities and social environments conducive to crime, right? So you have a limited number of places that have those features. So it may not be so easy to move from place to place. There are also not only a limited number of spaces that have opportunities, but I mentioned before, in the sort of social aspects of those places. And it's also true that it's much easier to be where you're familiar. Going to new websites, going to new chat rooms, it takes time to figure it out. So displacement, the problems of displacement, the resistance to displacement might be occurring here as well. And let's remember that offenders in the real world have limited rationality. They don't know everything, right? They make decisions only on partial information. And that's probably true of the internet as well. Many people may not research everything as thoroughly as they should have. They're making a decision with limited rationality, and that might also prevent them from displacing so easily. Familiarity, as I mentioned before, if you're familiar with places, well, you might feel, you know, concerned about going to a place you're not familiar. So my point is that many of these things, many of the features, the mechanisms that operate to prevent spatial displacement in the real world may prevent spatial displacement in the internet world, the cyber world, even if we take into account the idea of zero distance. And let me just give you the one study I know is a student of mine who worked for a company that tried to prevent the stealing of sports broadcasts. What was happening is that the broadcast is being done by a certain internet channel, and they make money by you signing up, and other people are stealing it and running it through other channels, right? And she worked in the company to prevent it, and she used this idea of identifying these sites, the ones that seemed to be the worst, and she blocked them. And what she found was that once she blocked those hotspots, you'd had some displacement, but not a hell of a lot. And you would have thought you would have much more. I would have thought much more at the time. So my only point is that some of these principles might operate here as well. Okay. So, you know, I've used this location, location, location. Understanding the places where crime occurs is critical for prevention, in my view, and is the most successful police prevention program, the one with the best evidence we've seen so far. It's time to start looking at cybercrime and thinking, can we capitalize on those opportunities of place by looking at whether there's a law of crime concentration and examining these sort of questions in cyberspace. Anyway, thank you very much. Any questions? Sure. I think you need a microphone.
Thank you, David, for the very stimulating presentation. Got my mind racing. And it's not a question, but two comments. The first one is, if we were looking at differences, we need to understand the differences between the physical spaces and the digital spaces. And I think a major difference is that in the digital realm, we can create new spaces all the time. In the physical space, there is a finite number of places. So the concentration has to be always on the same limited number. In digital, you can create a new website every minute, every second, if you want.
You know, I think you're absolutely right. As I said, people here probably know more about this than I do. This lecture forced me to think about this a bit more and working with Ed. And I think there are two issues here. One is that as you move from one idea to the other, you have to think about what the differences are, like zero distance or the ability to change the number of sites. It's not that places don't change, by the way. The number of streets in a city change, especially in cities that are new, they change all the time. If you go to a city that was started 30 years ago, and each 5 years you look at the number of streets, you're going to see it differently. By the way, in many larger cities, you have the opposite phenomenon, where streets disappear all of a sudden because of different land uses, etc. So it's not that you don't have changes, but you're absolutely right. The ability to create a new place here is different. The question is to think about that. I mean, I don't know. It's an interesting question. I mean, maybe the conclusion you would draw is that the denominator, let's go to what we're doing, the denominator normally used in place-based research is not right here. Maybe the denominator here should be of those of which you have one event would offend. But that leaves out identifying the sort of what makes places in that universe at all, what makes them problematic. Yeah, this is really interesting. I think that if people could figure out a way to sort of start to think this through, it would have a big impact. And it might not have the same opportunities that you have in place-based prevention, but it might.
Sorry. And the second comment, actually extending what you just said, is that the police might not have the data, but some other groups might have all the data, like the Googles and the private companies having a topology of the whole internet because that's their business. So FAIs, for example, the AT&T, Google, they map and they block an awful lot of content and block access to those problematic places. So maybe they might be actually better positioned than the police to be able to conduct this kind of work. And I think they already do it. We don't know exactly to what extent, but I think that your thinking might be very attractive to them in terms of understanding what they're doing and how it has an impact for the whole ecosystem of problematic online spaces.
Yeah, you know, again, a very interesting comment, and people should pursue this, Ed, and maybe you should pursue it with me, but that's a really interesting comment because another issue is here, which is the issue has been coming up in the hearings in the Congress. You know, here what we're essentially doing is giving private agencies. In criminal justice, there's experimentation with private prisons. Many countries, in Israel, for example, the Supreme Court said they can't be private prisons because rights are not things that private entities can be assured to develop because of profit motive, right? So in criminal justice, there's some flirting with these private entities, but ultimately there's a general view, I think, that the social control should be something the police are the key agents of, and the information collecting. Here we've given agencies like Facebook and Google and all these places, we've given them a power that we normally don't give to private agencies, right? So they might be using this for different purposes than the public good, right? Because the public good does. So it's another reason why, which I'm sure the guys in the Congress haven't thought as much about, another reason why we need to start regulating this in a way that gives the public sphere, human rights, for example, some control over what's going on, because this could get rather ugly. But you're exactly right. That's very interesting. Sure.
Thanks.
And what's your name again? I'm sorry.
Benoit.
Okay.
Thanks, David. It's very interesting to hear you speak, and more of a comment as well to react on you, Benoit. So I work for the Dutch National Police, and I focus on prevention of cybercrime, of offenders, so we come up with different interventions. And I just want to tell you guys what we have been doing, a project on Google, actually. So we have been posting warning banners about DDoS attacks, focusing on risk offenders of committing DDoS attacks. So in 2019, the NCA in the UK started noticing that booter services that provide DDoS attacks, they were advertising on Google So if somebody searched for example, free DDoS, which is illegal, committing a DDoS attack, they saw an NCA warning banner stating, thank you. That's the National Crime Agency. In the meantime, so this was the first time, but in the meantime, Ben Collier of Cambridge University was doing research on the effects of law enforcement against Buddha services, and he noticed a flattening of the amount of DDoS attacks, which was rising for the last few years. So this is actually happening. There are types of interventions where law enforcement goes onto the platforms, which is Google. People, like youngsters, learn to commit cybercrime on Google, on YouTube. And we are starting to come up with interventions, but we have to measure effects, and it's new. See, but it is possible.
Yes, and look, you're using what's often called nudges, right? It's been found to be effective in a number of areas. Like you put, like those things you pass that say you're speeding, that's a nudge. It gives you a happy face, or it's based on a psychological mechanism, right? So nudges have worked, but you see, the law of crime concentration to me is about identifying where you want to be spending your resources. If you want to put a warning up on websites, you may not have done this, but I tried to do it in the study, and they charge you for each website, right? They charge you some amount of money to put up the warning. I don't know if they're charging you. So another thing of efficiency. So you ought to be finding, you ought to be figuring out using, you know, academics ought to be figuring out, they're not now, what are the sites that are we should be focusing on? And then we can efficiently apply prevention, whether it's nudges, whether it's entrapment, like honeypots or other things, to try to do something about it. But see, it's really, what you're suggesting is that if you're, what you're suggesting is if we know where we're going, we can provide some prevention, and that's good. That's important evidence. But now the question becomes, how do we decide the focus? Focus, if you look at the National Academy of Sciences report on proactive policing published 2 years ago, the major finding is focus. If you want to be effective, don't spread your resources too much. Focus in on the high-rate people, the high-rate places, right? That is the approach that seems to work. Anyway, thank you very much. Your name again?
Wouter Kleinzoon. I will be presenting on Thursday about the research. So
I'd love to be there. I have to be somewhere else.
Thanks.
Thursday, sorry.
David, and thank you to everyone for making the effort to be here in person. Like many of you, this is my first presentation in person since March of 2020, when my partner Mike and I were presenting in Copenhagen and caught over in Europe when they started shutting all the flights down. So we thankfully got home so that we weren't stuck over there for months. And probably like the rest of you too, I've spent the last year and a half trying to keep myself busy because I haven't been able to do things like this and travel and eat out. So we bought a house and we've been doing home renovations. I almost brought you some before and after shots, but I couldn't figure out how to build them into this presentation. We've also been increasing our alcohol intake, watching old movies. As I was putting this presentation together, actually, one of those old movies kept running through my head. And some of you might be too young to know this one, but it's one of my favorites. We actually have the movie poster for this in our garage, our pandemic garage with a pool table and a home gym. It's Goodfellas. And there's a scene in Goodfellas where Henry Hill, who's played by Ray Liotta brilliantly, looks up in the air and he sees a helicopter tailing him. And after he realizes that the FBI have a tail on him and they're wiretapping him, he kind of descends into a paranoia. And that paranoia changes the way he does business. And I was going to put up a clip of that movie because it's just so perfect for what I'm going to discuss today. But I couldn't find a clip without really colorful language, so I decided not to. But what I'm going to talk to you, what's that? Yeah. Well, you never know. There's people watching and our funders. So the purpose of this study is really to, and it was the purpose, it was one of the purposes of the entire project, and this part of the project, as the other parts, were funded by PMI Impact, and we're very thankful for the funding. The purpose of this paper specifically that was done by Camille really took a leadership role here, but also collaborators and the leads of the study, David Décary-Hétu and Benoit Dupont, Jerry Ratcliffe, and myself, was to identify the impact of law enforcement operations that you've heard about already today, and you're going to continue. Austin's going to do a great presentation on another one after my presentation, and then we'll talk about it in the roundtable today. But really to try to assess the impact of these operations on dark web network cohesion. And if any of you know my work, you know that one of my areas that I work a lot in is social network analysis. And some of the research, a pretty big body of research with social networks or illicit networks and social network analysis, have really picked up on the positive association between network cohesion. And when I say network cohesion, I mean the amount of trust and the open communication and the way products flow through a network, that network cohesion and frequency of crime tend to be positively associated with one another. So when you have a more cohesive network, you likely have more crime going on because of that network. So there's this idea that if law enforcement operations could weaken network cohesion, this could be a really compelling strategy to try to reduce the amount of crime on the dark web and in traditional crimes on the street. So before I go into the results of this study specifically, I just wanted to talk a little bit about network cohesion in criminal networks in general, and then specific to criminal networks in the virtual environment, because it is different. It does have some similarities. Look, there was an unsafe, it's funny, we're in a cybercrime panel and there's unsafe warnings coming up on the computer. So the traditional view of organized crime is very Goodfellas-like. Right, we have this mafia hierarchy from the boss down to the sub capos and then all the way down. Very cohesive groups, trusting, well, for the most part, trusting amongst themselves until they get capped, and working in a very hierarchical communication comes from the top down. Well, about in the mid-1980s, there was a group of researchers, some of which are in this room, led by the work of Peter Reuter and others, that showed that that perspective wasn't really what was going on in most illicit economies. Most networks working in these spaces were actually quite flexible, loosely connected, so not tightly connected and cohesive, and they tended to be smaller, more specialized in what they did, and fairly geographically contained. And they also had more short-lived relationships, certainly than the traditional conception of this mafia-like organized crime. So cohesion sort of shifted in the way, or at least the way we thought about cohesion shifted after the 1980s in organized crime research. So how do we measure cohesion in groups? And this is where social network analysis, probably in the last 20-ish years, has come into play. We tend to measure it with metrics like group density, and that is just of the connections, however you want to measure those connections, that are present, and you divide them by the total number of possible connections. So it really is how much communication, how often people are talking to one another, and how people know each other in a group. Do all of them know each other? Do they talk? And so density tends to, in some way, indicate trust and cohesion as well. Criminal networks, at least in the traditional sense, when we consider a cohesive group, we tend to use the benchmark of about 80% density. Research has shown us, good research again over the last 20 years, that drug networks tend to have a density of about 1%. So way less cohesive, like I mentioned, than we at first thought. Centralization is another measure that we use to measure cohesion. Just how do we have central players? Are there central players that tend to be more powerful or organize communication or product supply in these groups? This is where, and in criminal networks, we tend to see a high number of people with a very small number of contacts. So most of the people that are operating in these spaces in illicit economies don't actually work with that many people. But we do have clustering. People that are clustered in small groups, and people tend not to, at least in the traditional markets, have a lot of reciprocity. So our relationships tend to go in one direction. You either get product in one direction or you communicate in one direction, and it's not necessarily reciprocated. In virtual settings, some of that's the same and some of it's different. So group density tends to be, actually it varies over studies. David's work showed about a 0.3% density. So that's even less than some of the drug networks that we see in the traditional markets. Thomas Holt's work showed about 28%. So some of the density is really determined by the type of illicit market that we're looking at on the virtual setting. Centralization is very similar to traditional markets. They tend to cluster in loosely connected subgroups, but we do have some differences. There tends to be more reciprocity, at least when we measure it by communication in a virtual setting. When you communicate with someone, they tend to communicate back to you. And again, there's reasons for that in the virtual world. Central actors tend to have less importance in the virtual world. And skilled actors, people that have technological skills or other skills that are unique to them, tend to be more central in a virtual setting than in a traditional world. When we look specifically at illicit drug networks, and the reason I'm setting the stage is because that's really what we're looking at for this paper, in virtual settings, they tend to be engaging in activity on crypto markets, and we've talked about crypto markets. David is the expert, the world expert on crypto markets. We tend to see that there's lots of vendors who sell, or lots of vendors that sell to very few buyers, so we don't really have centralization, but we do have a few vendors that sell to many individuals, so we do have some powerful individuals. But 25% of vendors in these crypto markets have no sales, at least that we can measure. But the individuals, just like the other markets online and in the traditional sense, do tend to be loosely connected in dense subgroups. People that work together a lot or sell to one another a lot, but they're loosely connected to one another. So some similarities to the online illicit markets outside of drugs and to the traditional illicit markets. The difference here, though, is that there tends to be less reciprocity. Like I said, vendors rarely, if ever, buy from the people that have bought from them, so they rarely buy from their buyers. And buyers are fairly loyal. About 60% of buyers are repeat customers to the vendor. So we have some unique things that are happening in illicit drug markets in a virtual setting. But what we want to look at here is the impact of police interventions on illicit drug networks. And there has been some research in this area. In the traditional sense, we've had a lot more research. And this is often called the iron law of drug prohibition, where we do see some short-term impacts of law enforcement efforts, often in the form of crackdowns, when law enforcement will go out and they'll crack down on street-level drug dealing. But we have seen operations as well targeting middle market dealing or even trying to get to the kingpins. But we've yet to see really long-term disruption here on the streets in traditional markets. Online, we've got very few studies, again, most of them being done by people in this room, with fairly similar findings. We failed to produce a long-term removal of individuals from crypto markets. We do tend to see a bit of a reduction in activity, but then it only takes a month or two or three for that activity to ramp up again. Why could that be? Well, when we actually look qualitatively at discussions on crypto markets, we see that few users actually mention being fearful of law enforcement efforts. They might know about them, but rather when they talk about it, it triggers discussions of how to innovate, how to get around these operations, and where they might go next. So we have issues of displacement that David Weisburd was talking about earlier. So this presentation, I'm glad that it was in the afternoon because you were given a lot of building blocks for it in the morning discussions. When we talk about how law enforcement efforts or operations might impact cohesion online and offline for that matter, we have to think about two different sort of competing theories, that of deterrence and that of identity theory. Deterrence suggests that individuals limit crime if the cost is increasing. So if there's law enforcement operations, they may reduce or stop their criminal activity because they're afraid of getting caught. And that would it would shrink the network, but it would also, theoretically, it would lower cohesion. People would become less trusting. They would communicate with less people because they don't want to get caught. Deterrence. On the other hand, we have identity, and there has been some research that's shown that from law enforcement operations, you might actually get an increase in cohesion. And we've seen this in some studies on the traditional markets, where as police activity ramps up, individuals, especially in the gang, the street gang setting, tend to have more of an us versus them identity, and they become more cohesive as groups. Theoretically, then their criminal activity would increase, so it almost has a backfire effect. So when we went into the study to look at how law enforcement operations actually affected network cohesion, we had these theories in the back of our head. Is it going to break cohesion down, or rather, is it going to have a backfire effect and actually increase cohesion? And no studies have looked at the impact of law enforcement efforts on online network cohesion yet. So this is the first of its kind. So to the current study, we looked at two different law enforcement interventions, both of which Jap mentioned earlier today. Operation East River, which occurred in April of 2019, and it brought down the second largest crypto market at the time, the Wall Street market, again, that's been mentioned already. And three of their administrators were arrested. And Deep.Web, and this was in, again, just a couple weeks later, in 2019, and it was the shutdown of a news platform and the rest and an arrest of some of their administrators. The data that we looked at for the study were forum posts from the Dread forum. And what Dread is, for those of you that don't know, it's one of the top news platforms on the dark web. So basically, it's where people engage in, they talk about illicit drug dealing, they talk about other things that are going on the dark web. And this really emerged after Reddit banned talking about or discussions on illicit drug dealing and illicit drug trafficking on the internet. So Reddit banned it, so you had something crop up on the dark web, which was Dread, and some other news forums as well. Our other data source is David's amazing, I've worked with David for so long, and he's just the easiest person to work for because he owns his data and collects it all, so we don't have to get data from police agencies, which is usually where I get most of my data. He uses his tool, Data Crypto, to really collect information from the Dread market, Darknet markets, which is a subsection of Dread that really talked about illicit drug dealing and the impact and some of the impact of law enforcement operations as well. We collected all the messages from February 2nd, 2018 to June 13th of 2020, so about 122 weeks. And just to situate, our data collection was sort of right in the middle where we had Operation East River and Operation Deep.Web. So what we're going to measure here when we talk about the impact of these operations on the messages, we're going to measure whether activity was changed. And activity is measured using two different things. One is the number of people actually sending messages on Dread, and the number of messages that were being sent. And then when we look at social cohesion, we're going to use some social network measures. And I'm not going to go into these too much. I'll talk a bit more when I talk about them in results. But one is the average degree, basically the average number of people each person in the network sends messages to. And the centralization, so do we have sort of people that are sending a lot of message, and do those people tend to be located in the center of the network? Reciprocity, I mentioned already. Are connections reciprocal? Density, I mentioned already. Average geodesic distance, which is really, think of the 7 degrees of Kevin Bacon. It's how many jumps does it take for you to get to someone else in the network? So it's the average of that. How many jumps does it take for someone to reach everyone in the network? Low geodesic distance would be very cohesive. High, not cohesive. And cliques. We all know cliques from high school, right? Well, cliques and social network analysis are basically the same. They're these closed networks, and we specifically looked at closed triads, closed groups of three people. And the analysis we use, social network analysis, and an interrupted time series. Again, I'm not going to bore you with the details, but basically interrupted time series looks at an exogenous event, it's called. That was our law enforcement operations that were clustered in about 3 weeks in the middle of our data collection. We looked at the activity and some of these other social network measures pre-operation and during the operations and then post-operations using this statistical technique. And what did we find? So here's what we found. The activity, and these are just some plots, but what I want you to pay attention to are those trend lines. All right, so let's look at all the measures and let's really see what happened. The line in the middle, those those lines. That's just our 3 weeks of law enforcement operations. Remember, these were two separate operations, one coming in late April, one coming in early May of 2019. I also want to, not to go off on a tangent, but I also want to remind you that Jap mentioned there was other operations going on in 2019 too. It was a very active time for taking down crypto markets for law enforcement. So activity, we actually saw that the number of actors on the Dread platform was, or the Dread forum, was pretty stable pre-intervention. During the intervention, not surprisingly, this is a news forum, it spiked. People were talking about it, right? People were freaked out. And then after, we saw a significant decreasing trend. And that went for the entirety of our post. I'll talk a bit more about that in a minute, but for the entirety of our post implement or intervention period. In fact, it was a decrease of about 8.52 actors per week, so a constant decrease. The number of messages, exactly the same trends. Stable, spiked during the interventions, and then significant decreasing trend where every week we saw a decrease of about 22 per week for the entirety of our post-implementation, about 52 weeks. How about some of those social network metrics? Well, the average degree, and this is how many people each person is connected to in the network, so how many people you're sending messages to, stable pre-intervention, spike during the intervention, and a significant decrease after the intervention. Are you sensing a theme? Average geodesic distance. Remember, I mentioned that the higher it gets, the less cohesive your group is, the lower it is, the more cohesive. We saw it stable pre, spike during the, or stable during the interventions. Again, we didn't have that much difference in geodesic distance, and then a significant increase, so getting less cohesive after the interventions. Closed triads, we saw the same thing, or same result. Stable pre-intervention. There was a spike within the first 2 weeks of the intervention, but then actually a decrease the third week. And then we saw a significant decreasing trend. So as you get less and less of those closed, dense subgroups, you have a less cohesive network. So we saw cohesion decreasing after interventions. Density, we saw something interesting. Stable pre-intervention, not that the other results weren't interesting, stable during the interventions, but then we saw an increase of about 1% per week after the interventions. And an increase in density tends to be, you tend to connect to an increase in cohesion. So this is kind of contradictory to some of the other social network metrics that we found. Centralization, we didn't see much of a difference pre, post, stable, almost throughout. And reciprocity, we actually saw an increasing trend pre-intervention, but then we saw it stabilize after the interventions. This is all in the paper too that'll hopefully be published soon. You'll be able to get more detail on the stats if you want it or on some of the results. So what are some of the takeaways here? Well, network activity decreased after the law enforcement interventions. We see that from number of actors and number of messages. And this decrease was more sustained compared to other research that's been done in this area. Décary-Hétu, David saw in 2017, saw about a 1 month reduction of activity after law enforcement efforts. And then Saska and Kristen in 2015 saw about a 2 to 3 month reduction, but then everything ramped up again. We saw a sustained over 52 week reduction for the entirety of our data collection. The only reason we didn't continue seeing it is because we stopped data collection. The takeaway here and why we might have found a more sustained reduction is because of the sort of the multiple police operations. Remember what David Weisburd was saying earlier about displacement? Well, some of the earlier studies did see that, you know, you had a limited and then it was displaced to other crypto markets. Other crypto markets cropped up and there was just as much activity. We've actually seen, at least when we're measuring it through Dread communications, talking about activity to be a sustained reduction after that middle part of 2019. Here's the interesting part. So cohesion, right? The meat, we have activity reducing, but what happened to cohesion in this online forum? Well, we saw, just as we anticipated and just as other research shows, that the online networks are loose, low centralization, moderate reciprocity, high clustering, exactly what we've seen in other research. But we had these competing findings, and I mentioned them already. Networks became more diffuse because geodesic distance increased and closed triads decreased, but then we had density actually increasing. And there's two possible ways to interpret this, and we're still sort of going back and forth about, and maybe some analysis, maybe looking at a combined measure that we can look at, because as networks get smaller, they inherently get more dense. And what we saw here is that the DREAD network got smaller after the interventions. So is the density effect, rather than signifying an increase in cohesion, rather is it just a network effect that's inevitable when you have a shrinking network? So that's one takeaway, would be that interpretation, that the law enforcement interventions did reduce network cohesion through reducing subgroup activity. And density is just sort of that inevitability of a shrinking network. The other interpretation is that our results cancel each other out, that we had density that was decreased, the group was getting tighter, and then we had subgroup breakdown so that law enforcement operations didn't tend to have a substantial impact on cohesion. And we've got to tease out those findings. So the conclusion here, and I hope we have time for questions, is that multiple law enforcement interventions did produce a sustained reduction in market activity, actors and messaging. But the change in cohesion is a little bit more debatable. And that leads us to more questions than answers, at least when it comes to cohesion and the effect of law enforcement operations in an online environment. Is criminal network efficiency linked to cohesion in a virtual environment? Is there an online criminal group identity? Remember, we had this idea that the identity of individuals might be impacted by law enforcement operations. Well, maybe in a virtual setting, identity is much different than in a traditional setting because you tend to have anonymity. People don't know each other in real life. So you might not have this, perhaps online environments and groups are the cohesion so low to begin with, it's impossible to break it down even further. That's what I mentioned there. Does the anonymity, uncertainty, and low trust inherent in these environments really make that baseline of cohesion so low that law enforcement operations aren't really going to affect it? But in the end, we came to the conclusion, doesn't matter. Because we reduced activity, the messages and the actors over such a sustained period, maybe that's the money, right? Maybe that's the meat. Is that we reduced activity enough that maybe cohesion and looking at the impact of cohesion in these types of environment isn't indicative of criminal activity. Rather, it is that very obvious measure of activity, number of people on, number of crimes that are occurring, and number of messages. Thank you so much, and thank you to my co-authors who did the meat of this.
Is there any question? Well, I've got one. do you think that the cohesion of the in the virtual setting have a displacement in the real world?
Well, yes. That's a really good question. And you know, the next step of this, and we've been doing, David's team has been doing some of this, looking at the qualitative analysis mm-hmm. of what's actually being said in the DREAD forum, I think we're going to get hints to that. So my cop-out answer is we don't know yet, but we're hoping that some of the qualitative information will give us a bit of a hint there.
Thank you. Any question? Mm-hmm. Oh, there. Who's first?
Thanks. To what extent do you think this also translates to different online markets where they, for example, sell leaked data, for example?
Yeah, really good question. And if you were to follow the diffusion of benefits literature that we see in traditional markets, you would have to say that it would have to.
Yeah.
We don't know, we don't have the evidence for that, but theoretically it should. If it's impacting one market, then it should be impacting others, maybe to a lesser extent, but we don't have evidence for that yet.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Seisha Kataneni. I have a question. You talked about anonymity, and is the anonymity is the only factor or one of the factors? How about identity flexibility? Because they change their names all the time.
Yeah.
So how do you define subgroup? Because they keep changing their names online.
That is always a big limitation to these papers. I mean, David, I think, could talk about that for ages, and he has ways to try to link different identities to one another, but it's an inherent limitation in the study. Really good point.
Jesse Crow with the Wisconsin Department of Justice. Do you think there's a correlation to the dark web here and to the clear web, like standard apps or social networking where we operate on mostly for undercover, and how that affects it? So example is, in Florida does large operations almost every month, and Georgia does, where they arrest 30, 40, 50 people every month in these undercover operations, and it keeps continuing every month. Do you think they're, how does that relate, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, it again, theoretically, it should be related, basing on the diffusion of benefits literature and the, you know, just deterrence literature in general. You have one thing happening over here, it should impact what's happening over there. However, I think it's more difficult to get the level of awareness on the clear web that you have on the dark web. The dark web is just smaller. You have less forums. When you take something down, it's one of the big 12. You know, it's just something huge. ClearNet, you're taking, it's just the whack-a-mole is so much bigger there, because you take something down, you advertise an operation, and it only gets to a very, very small portion of the clear web. So I think it's much more difficult. I think you'd have to have far more operations that made a difference for it to have the kind of impact that you see on the dark web.
David, am I allowed to ask a question as a co-author of this paper? Or so, Ailey, do you think it might be possible that what we're seeing is maybe cohesion, but also another concept like resilience of this network, and that maybe we need to also try to think about how to accommodate that, because the size is reducing, so all the more weakly involved people are leaving, but the people remaining, they know they are challenged, and they try to devise new ways of persist or to make themselves more resistant to future police interventions?
Benoit, I think that's a really brilliant insight, and I think there's a paper in that based on this data, because we certainly have seen that in traditional markets. So yes, I do think that we have to start thinking about something outside of cohesion. Cohesion has dominated this discussion in trying to be the sole indicator of criminal activity, but I think we can look at some resilience of markets and those people that just stay. And what does it say? Like, what do those people represent? Are they our kingpins? Are they stupid? Okay, thank you so much.
Everyone, my name is Austin Barrier. I'm a special agent with Homeland Security Investigations in our Phoenix field office. And my presentation is going to be a little bit different. It's going to be more from the viewpoint of law enforcement. I'll admit, when I was first asked to give this talk, I was a little nervous, as I've never spoken before to academia. And my concern is that the observations that we in law enforcement, those that are out there actually doing the investigations, that the observations that we have would conflict with perhaps some of the studies that academia produces, you know, that we are at opposite ends of the spectrum. And here today, I've been, I would say, pleasantly surprised, but I'm glad to see that what we're seeing in the field is absolutely mirroring a lot of the discussions and a lot of the projects and stuff. So we're going to talk about what was Project Mercury. This was actually a three-year online investigation that, frankly, law enforcement stumbled into by accident. It focused on child sexual exploitation on the internet, specifically offenders that were using various types of platforms, from the dark web to social media to end-to-end encrypted chats to even live streaming to sexually abuse children in real time, and then to share that with other offenders. One of the platforms that was used that everybody is aware of nowadays and uses almost every day is Zoom. But we go in the way back machine, 2014, 2015, when we first started this investigation, very few people were familiar with it. So again, I said that we came into this by accident. So our colleagues with the NCA in the United Kingdom in late 2014 stumbled into these individuals. The gentleman there, the third from the left, dialed the police and told them he was, you know, contemplating suicide, he was thinking about taking his own life. And then when the constables responded to his house, they asked why. And what he shared with them was that he had been conspiring with these other individuals on, again, different spaces on the internet, the dark web, they were using social media, and at that time, Zoom, which almost nobody had heard of, to abuse children. And we talk about the networks and stuff. These individuals, even though they lived across the UK, they weren't just communicating online. They were actually traveling around the country and meeting in person. Now, what we did find out from this investigation that the NCA did is that they had a number of victims. They had 3 live victims, and they had 21 other victims that, while they didn't offend these children in real time, they were children that they groomed and brought them from other spaces. They brought them from gaming platforms, from social media, from other platforms that kids inhabit, and they brought them to these spaces, first the dark web, and then to Zoom. When we first start looking at this offender network, we had to figure out why, or what were the issues that we were gonna have to face as law enforcement. The first one was that they were a multi-platform network. You know, and we'll talk about it momentarily, but oftentimes in law enforcement, when we investigate these types of networks, we focus on one platform or one type of platform. You know, they're peer-to-peer offenders, or they're dark web offenders, or perhaps they're trolling the social media or gaming sites. But we realized that these individuals were coordinated and had a division of labor. They also were exceptionally security conscious. Something that is, again, common nowadays, but was not in 2014-15 when we first started, was the live streaming aspect. That was part of their security functionality. It's very easy to figure out if somebody's a law enforcement officer if everybody involved in the crime has to be on camera, right? It's very difficult for me to be sitting in my cubicle, or, you know, an NCA officer or an officer somewhere else sitting in their cubicle with other colleagues in the background. So that was one of our hurdles. And then finally, the fact that they were actually globally coordinated. We very early on found evidence where we had individuals, like I said, in all the Five Eyes countries, on every continent. We actually had IPs of all things pinging out of Antarctica. I'm hoping that was just some kind of, you know, random thing. I don't think there's enough people down there to do this. But we found out that they were coordinating globally. We had individuals whose jobs were to find kids. We had individuals whose jobs were to recruit the kids. We had individuals whose jobs were to organize the meetings and send that information out. As has been discussed, you know, for an investigation to be effective, we had to have a division of labor. Early on, we realized that different countries have different rules, different laws, different regulations that they have to follow. So, for example, here in the U.S., to do online undercover work is much easier, say, for example, in the U.K., where they need, you know, higher levels of permission. The legal standards in different countries are different. So what we did is we identified amongst the partner agencies and the nations that were participating what their specialty was, what they were good at, what they were allowed to do, what they were capable of, and we assigned those duties to them. And then we also finally had a meeting in Toronto early on in the investigation with all the pertinent investigators and the prosecutors to establish a baseline. Again, we talk about international cooperation, and from the law enforcement perspective, as the investigative officer or the cop on the beat, one of the hurdles that we have to deal with in international cooperation is bureaucracy. Oftentimes, by the time I receive information from our colleagues in the Dutch police, there's been, as we discussed earlier, you know, it's more like 20 degrees of Kevin Bacon, and it's been so watered down that we don't have the proper information. So we established a baseline. What is the work product that would meet the prosecutorial standards for all the partner countries? Which was actually the hardest part, right? Realizing that, for example, in the UK, you need reasonable suspicion. In the US, we need probable cause. And then there are some other countries who can do things that just baffle my mind that are completely different, and we can't talk about that here, but that they can do things that we can't do. So we put this, we're gonna talk real briefly, and you know, this is about child exploitation, so unfortunately there are some, you know, some topics that might make people feel a little uncomfortable, but this was all put to test very early on. July of 2015 was when this concept was put to test. We knew stuff was happening on these different spaces, on the dark web, and on Zoom, and some of these other places, but we didn't have a grasp on it yet. We hadn't really infiltrated these networks to the point where we had observed it. This was our theory. This was based on interviews, you know, evidence collected from the scene, but this wasn't something we had seen in real time. But on July 22nd, 2015, this all came to a head for us. A detective constable in Toronto, she happened to be logged in and witnessed what turned out to be the live abuse in real time of a six-year-old boy. Now, there was individuals logged in from around the world. There was approximately 50 individuals logged in. They were talking about it. They were coordinating the actual abuse. They were telling the abuser what to do. They were saying, hold on, let me go get my friend, let me bring my buddy in. And they were actually going out and recruiting other people to come watch and to egg on, to goad on the abuser. The good thing where this networking comes in is within 14 hours, we were able to identify that victim. And again, this was back when nobody knew who Zoom was. We went from Toronto to Phoenix, Phoenix to San Jose to Atlanta, Atlanta to rural Pennsylvania. And within 14 hours, our law enforcement partners in Pennsylvania were able to intervene and get that young boy to safety. And we'll talk about more about that later. So early on in this investigation, we had to kind of do a shift in our thinking. For a long time, I've been working child exploitation investigations since before smartphones, right? For some people, you know, back when, not so far back as news groups were the thing, but not long after that. And there was this thought process that as the technologies changed that the abusers were using, that they would leave old technology, right? Oh, there's news groups, oh, cool, there's peer-to-peer, we're gonna move to BitTorrent. That's no longer the cutting-edge tech, we're gonna move to social media or file sharing or the dark web. And because of that process, or that evolutionary process, a lot of people in law enforcement found themselves saying, well, we're not gonna focus on these other platforms, or the offenders themselves are not using those platforms, that they're gonna be in a silo, right? So for a long time, what we saw was investigations were focused on a certain platform, not on networks. So in the law enforcement world, you would have investigators saying, oh, I'm a peer-to-peer guy, meaning that they just worked peer-to-peer, or my skill set is working undercover chats, or I'm a dark web investigator, not realizing that the offenders aren't putting themselves in silos. We, as law enforcement, were putting them in silos, you know, based on some incorrect beliefs. This is the reality of it, right? So specifically in a child exploitation world, offenders are gonna go where there's content and where there's access to children. We still to this day see offenders who meet up in person, almost like in a dead drop, you know, some kind of espionage thing, where they meet in a park and they hand each other thumb drives. That's not the most common, but if that's effective and that's what works for them, if that's how they can feel secure and safe and get the content that they need, that's what they'll do. So we realized, and this investigation, because when we were getting into the homes and doing the search warrants and getting into their devices and even just engaging them real time in undercover capacity, we realized that they were moving us as, you know, thinking that we were one of them. They're taking us to different platforms. You know, we started off thinking they were just gonna be on just the dark web and maybe Skype or something like that, and maybe Zoom, but they were actually introducing us to other places where they were coordinating their activity. So the offenders, they have this balancing act that we observed. So on one side, they have their anonymity, their security, and their privacy, right? That makes sense. I mean, they obviously don't want to get caught. The anonymity, you know, they want to maintain their, they don't want us to know who they are for obvious reasons. If a colleague of theirs in their world can figure out who they are, you know, law enforcement can. But that's also balanced with, if they're too anonymous, they can't communicate with each other. Then the idea of security, they protect their content. Their content is a tangible good that they can trade. It's a commodity. So they protect it because it's theirs, if they're a producer of this type of material, but because it's a commodity, they also have to use it to gain access to other spaces or to gain other fresh content or new content. And that, you know, if they were just to sit on that new content and not share it with individuals, we in law enforcement would never see it, but because they share it with others, eventually it comes to our notice. And then the privacy, right? I mean, they don't like, even though they don't like being tracked across the internet, and they don't necessarily want individuals to know that, you know, Austin Barrier on the dark web is also Austin Barrier on Zoom, is also Austin Barrier on Skype, eventually they have to get over that because they need to share that information with other offenders. And then we have the other side of their needs, content and access. Right, the new content is something that they're always searching for, and if they can, have access to children. And this balancing act oftentimes is something that law enforcement, I don't want to say can manipulate because that would be incorrect, but we can exploit that weakness. At some point, their need for new content, their need to access, for access to children, overcomes that security, that urge, right, to be safe. And that's what we focused on in this investigation. Again, it was 3 years. Very few of our offenders were identified and arrested within, say, the first 6 months. There was a lot of buildup, building on that need for them to balance security and their access to content and stuff. So we're going to talk about the engagement. Like I mentioned earlier, we had to come up with a division of labor. Now that's mostly because different law enforcement agencies have different capabilities. If I know there's some individuals here from the UK, for example, from my understanding in the United Kingdom, to do online engagements, that takes a very high level of approval. In the US, it's much easier to do. So we had division of labor. That was one of my jobs. My job was to go out and engage the offenders in real time. We also realized that we, as law enforcement, could use a lot of the same techniques that they use on the children, the grooming techniques, to groom them. You know, we realized very early on that the basic human needs of the sense of feeling like you belong to a group, not wanting to be lonely, wanting to have friends, these very basic human social needs, these offenders have those too. Just because they are, you know, criminals or they have a sexual interest in children doesn't relieve them of these desires to find other like-minded individuals. And that was actually probably the best way that we could infiltrate their network, was to use those or to exploit those human needs. Now, very early on, we realized that we had stumbled into a pretty significant organization. And as was discussed in the last talk, this isn't an organization like a mafia where you have a boss at the top. You know, it was more like a confederacy, right? Like a loose organization of individuals. Certain individuals were known as having access. Certain individuals were known as having the ability to organize. Other individuals were technically savvy. Some were very security conscious. And nobody had formal jobs or formal duties, but it was just kind of this understanding. And there was rules in place as well. Those rules were, you know, everything from how you behave and how you talk to each other. If you're going to ask for content, how to be polite, not to demand. If the what language everybody would communicate in. Interestingly enough, some of the worst arguments, I guess you could say, between the offenders, was based on the fact that there was a language barrier. So rules were established that everybody had to use Google Translate, for example. But to give you an idea of the scope of the problem, within the first 30 days, we tracked some numbers. Now, I know that this doesn't look like large numbers compared to some like the traditional dark web forums where you have tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of users that are logged in or have access. But these numbers represent individuals that actually logged in and watched a live abuse of a child. So they had communicated with other individuals on different platforms, whether it was, again, the dark web or, you know, let's say Kick or Skype or something along those lines, and then took this overt step to go and watch the live abuse. And some pretty significant numbers there in one month, you know, over 3,000 in the US. Some of the countries only had a handful. But as the investigation went on, these numbers just skyrocketed. We actually gave up on keeping track of these numbers. You know, police, we're not, you know, the cops on the beat, we're not really statisticians. So we just gave up. The numbers were just massive. So we talk about, you know, was there a type for this crime type? I mean, I think there's a pretty obvious type going on up here on the screen, but it was across a wide range of individuals. We had clergymen, we had lawyers, we had police, We had doctors and nurses, politicians, teachers, people with access to children. But again, the common thing was that, believe it or not, these were very, I won't say chatty individuals, but they had this need and this desire to find other like-minded individuals. They had this desire to belong. They gave up at some point, they made this conscious decision to give up on the security and the privacy to seek out other like-minded individuals and to coordinate their activity, hiding behind this belief that the security apparatus they had put in place was protecting them. The entire top row there, they were involved, except for the minister at the end, were involved in the live abuse of that first little boy. Again, we have pretty much everybody else up there at some point had access to kids, and this is just a fraction of the number. At the end of this, we indicted nearly 300 individuals. The lady there on the third row, she ran a daycare center, like I said, a number of school teachers. The individual next to the lady, he actually worked at a school for autistic children, and he's actually in the classroom with the kids there, you know, looking at watching, you know, watching abuse material. Politicians, ministers, the individual down there for our friends from the UK, the individual in the bottom row on the far left, I guess he was friends with the head of GCHQ under the Theresa May administration, and when the head of GCHQ had to resign, it was apparently because he was friends with this three-time convicted sex offender who was also a defrocked priest. So, after 3 years, what did we get for all our efforts? Did we disrupt an area of the internet? Some people would say no, because it's still going on. I would say that we did. Zoom is still a problem, right? During COVID, there was Zoom bombing, obviously, which turned out to be not based so much on the platform not being compliant or helpful. It was more on the fact that individuals were putting meeting IDs and passwords out where it could simply be found through Google, right, on the school websites and stuff. But we did. We indicted nearly 300 individuals, identified and removed almost 100 children from harm. But the real one of the real success stories was we actually worked with the company Zoom, who identified what separated a meeting where abuse was occurring versus a meeting like we would be having today. And they actually changed their platform. They changed their terms of use to make it harder. They implemented technology to target abuse rooms, to target individuals that were involved in abuse. And then they made the proactive step of then reporting that, not just to NCMEC, but to law enforcement directly. So we did actually impact that one space. We saw a precipitous drop near the end of 2018 to the point where I actually called Zoom and said, what have you guys done? We went from last week it being a mess to this week, there's nothing. And that's what they shared. They had, you know, their CEO had said, finally, this is enough. We're gonna do something to implement those changes. So we go back to the little boy at the beginning. I always like to close with this, you know, for a good story. That's the two men who primarily were his abusers. The first individual was his big brother. That was his primary carekeeper, or his caregiver. He was sentenced to a significant time in prison, as you can see there. And then the individual below was a neighbor who lived in the same town that they were abusing the boy together, and they were putting it out there on the internet. That little boy, the U.S. Attorney's Office, Homeland Security Investigations, and local prosecutors and police, we worked with the Hershey School, which is a private school in Pennsylvania. And that little boy is there now where he's receiving a world-class education. He's receiving medical care as well as, you know, ongoing psychological care until he turns 18. So some of the lessons that we learned from this, they're pretty evident here. One of the first issues that we had to deal with was law enforcement bureaucracy, whether that's a dark web investigation, whether that's a multi-platform investigation like this, but we had to figure out a way to communicate effectively between investigators. And we also had to focus on the legal differences, and not just the legal differences, but the actual operational capabilities. Not every country, not every law enforcement agency has a footprint on dark web platforms, on peer-to-peer platforms, or whatever kind of platform it is. So we had to divide that labor, figure out who had the strengths, who had the weaknesses, and give clearly defined and delineated jobs. We just couldn't say, we couldn't have a 5-minute phone call and say, okay, you're gonna do this, I'm gonna do that, cool, what we'll call it even. No, we actually had to, you know, it wasn't quite an MOU, but it was a very firm handshake gentleman's agreement. The other part was, too, is we can't sit back and wait for the new spaces on the internet to be brought to our attention. If we had just, if the UK law enforcement had just done the bare minimum with those first offenders that we saw at the beginning of, this, of the presentation, you know, just arrested those and went on their way, then we wouldn't have known about this network, this organization of offenders that were using different platforms to bring children to Zoom to commit the live abuse. So we have to be, law enforcement has to be proactive. We have to be constantly looking for the new technology. We can't just be sitting back waiting for NCMEC referrals or for a case to come in from our supervisor. We need to be engaging with whether it's academia or industry, NGOs, our kids who tell us what the cool platforms are, but we have to go out and search for those spaces where the crime is occurring. And that ties into this last part here, which is that, again, the offenders are constantly changing. If we go back to, again, the earliest slide, where there's this belief that offenders, or as tech changes, offenders leave one platform and go to the next and leave that previous platform behind, we're missing a great opportunity to sometimes identify these actors and offenders who are on these spaces where we don't have the ability to identify them, right? Or that ability is severely diminished. Oftentimes, we can find them in other spaces, and by putting that data together, whether it's evidentiary or academic research, we can then identify these individuals. And that's pretty much what I have this afternoon. There's my contact information, if anybody would like it. Normally, this is a little bit longer discussion. I go into like more how we did it and some techniques. But if anybody has any questions, I think we have a few minutes. Except for Jesse, you can't ask me any questions.
This is more of a comment, Austin. You are a terrific presenter, by the way. I'm blown away. But Austin's presentation is just indicative of how much we learned through this project interviewing law enforcement officers. Too often in academia, we're stuck and, you know, we look at the data and we don't actually engage with the interviews. And what we learned from people like you, Austin, boots on the ground, it was just phenomenal. And thank you so much for doing this.
Oh, great. Thank you. My pleasure.
Hi, my name is Hannah Lee. I'm actually asking a question on behalf of my students who are watching this online streaming. And do you have any kind of suggestions or recommendation for the students who are interested in working in the field like you?
Yes. Can definitely continue your education, right? Go ahead and get that degree. And then, I don't want to say pad your resume, but do as many different things as you can. Our agency, a lot of U.S. federal agencies have paid internships that they can put in for. If they wish to go into cyber investigations in general, I mean, definitely, you know, there's plenty of coursework they can go and take, right? They can work on, you know, forensic certifications. There's plenty of NGOs in the U.S. that do free trainings. National White Collar Crime Center does some fantastic trainings that are free, and that will just, and then apply to everybody.
Any other questions?
Great, thank you.
Any questions to start us off? Otherwise, I have some very crunchy things to ask them. Go ahead. We have a microphone coming to you. So you guys can fight off. We'll have two microphones for you guys. Fight off, and we'll see who wants to answer a question.
All right. So, sorry, beforehand, this might be a difficult one, but a week ago I was in London speaking to the Home Office, and we had a discussion with Abraham Sweary. I don't know if anybody knows him, but he asked me, can we, as academics, can you measure the effects of interventions, prevent interventions, or how we want to change behavior of possible offenders, can we measure them in different ways than just self-reports? Or do we
always need to rely into some sort of a self-report. Can you do it in an experimental setting, or can you? So I said sorry beforehand, but I'm wondering how, so to give some clarification about why I'm asking this, my job is to come up with new interventions to prevent offenders from committing cybercrime. And we always want to figure out, is it useful what we do and why, and what are the effects? That's also why I'm here. But are we constrained to just self-reports? And then if is that a problem? Thanks.
You gave us an easy one. I mean, it's the million-dollar question, isn't it? Is what we're doing actually making, is it working in the long term? What is the scope of the effect? And as academics, evaluation-oriented academics, that's what we're always trying to assess. I've been evaluating police interventions for my entire career, as have many of us on this project and in the room. Success can be measured a number of ways, and I think that's indicative really with Austin's presentation as well. He was saying, look, here's measures of success, and that's very explicit and very tangible effects. And then when I was presenting, it was a little more, you know, large in scope. Did it disrupt a whole element of the dark web? Yes, there are ways to measure it, but what it comes down to is quality of the data that we're getting. And unfortunately, sometimes that's difficult, especially when you're working with law enforcement agencies, and you know this better than I do, probably. And when you are working with something as ephemeral as the internet, it's changing all the time, and it's hard for us to keep up with that displacement. I think David Weisburd's presentation was good at refocusing us there in just how different the internet is than the traditional world, where we can see, yeah, we reduced crime in this area and it didn't go to blocks. Well, yes, we took down this cryptomarket. This many others cropped up, but now you've got different platforms. You've got to constantly be thinking innovatively. You have to have tech knowledge. So yes, I think you absolutely can rely on more than self-report. It's up to us in law enforcement and in academia to constantly be staying at least on par with the offenders, at least engage, you know, talking to them and getting that experience, the knowledge, but also talking to our law enforcement colleagues and tapping into the expertise that us in academia have for evaluating. And I just went on for far too long.
And I think that a lot of the data is held, as I said this morning, by private companies. So if you want to have an idea of the impact of an intervention, we should ask Google and Verizon and AT&T. So from a technical perspective, this is very doable, because what they're doing to ensure that you have access to your Netflix consistently is exactly the same kind of work that could extract data to understand what's happening. From a privacy perspective, I'm not very sure that this is something that we would like to see happening. But for botnets, for example, so let's say interventions on botnets, FAIs, ISPs, sorry, in English, I'm thinking in French and speaking in English. So ISPs, they have access. So there are in the States maybe 10 ISPs having access to 95% of all the traffic, including bad traffic. So they see spikes and highs and lows, and they can compare that with your intervention, see what's happening. They're so big, they don't really have a tradition of working with law enforcement in a preventative approach. You know, they comply when they get production orders from judges, but they don't think necessarily in terms of at-scale prevention. So I think the work would be to try to convince them to release some of the data, or to accept to carry out some type of analysis to show the impact of interventions, because they are the only ones, you know, telcos and banks and Google. And that's about, and Microsoft and Apple. And you have 10 types of organization, and that's it. And you could actually do some very interesting stuff, but then the privacy dimension is really something that we need to solve, and, you know, the confidence of the people. If the police starts to access those type of information.
Well,
as a researcher, I am not interested at all to hold data coming from, you know, very private, to hold very private. Universities are very bad at securing their systems. I don't want to be responsible for that. I never will be. So that's when I work with the banks, I keep the data in their vaults and I send my students there. I never bring in data to the university. This would be a terrible, terrible thing to happen.
Thank you. So maybe I'll follow up with another question that's, you know, very important to me, and I'm sure to you guys as well, and then we'll go back to the audience for more questions. So the one thing that really amazed me today was the number of police operations going online, the number of people have been arrested. You mentioned, you know, this forum, all these people that were arrested. Do you have a feeling that we take enough advantage of all the data that we have in terms of, you know, evidence collected by the police? Either because these data is going to lead to more investigations, but of the forum that you were just talking about, you mentioned there was a number of arrests, but, you know, how many of these people in the forum were actually arrested, and how long will these investigations be going on? And for us as researchers, I mean, I'm just, you know, watering at the idea of having access to all of this data to do all this research that could help law enforcement do a better job after that. So how do we make sure that every evidence that is seized, every information that is collected by law enforcement is used to the maximum level and benefits society and the country's law enforcement as much as possible? So how do we achieve that, basically?
Yeah, thanks. Very, very good question. Well, I think we're doing better lately in the last couple of years. So all the intelligence and the information from online forums are used to a much greater extent than maybe 5 or 10 years ago. And I don't know your perspective, but I think in the last couple of years there really have been trails of arrests where very high-ranking forum members who weren't just active on one forum, but on many other forums as well, where one arrest led to the arrest of others. So I think law enforcement has become more effective, even to the point where offenders were starting to question, like, should we still be active or should we find other ways? But still, I've mentioned the numbers. It's still the tip of the iceberg. So I'm not saying that it's perfect. I think we have to find ways to even use that intelligence in a better way. And I believe, because, you know, I'm talking about projects that, you know, it's not something you do on a daily basis as law enforcement. So it would really help if there's stronger relationships between law enforcement agencies and scientists. And it really comes again back to the security thing. I know law enforcement, they're not very, very willing to share their data. And that's a tricky thing. I was lucky that I was working for law enforcement previously, and when you know people and when they know that you're sound and when they believe in the project you're doing, well, you can do projects like that, but it's not a common thing. But again, I think there's some good example of interesting projects in the last couple of years where researchers have worked together, so it's growing, but there's a lot of steps to take.
And if I may add to that, we've spoken about a number of arrests today, and that is a very good positive sign. But if we look at the cyber operations, for example, in ransomware, a lot of those arrests were quite high up players, like an admin in Ukraine or some affiliates of We Evil. But it doesn't necessarily say that we have the kingpins or the developers. I assume that some of them are still, you know, beyond our control. So that's one thing I wanted to note. We have to pay attention to that. And then, if you would have a burglary and you investigate it and you find traces and then you catch the burglar and he's sent to jail, that's simple. But nowadays, we seize so much information that could lead to identification of other suspects or could lead to other criminal activity. But the challenge there is to be creative and to use new technology in order to go through those data. So I think there were already a couple of interesting sprints organized, and analysis sprint is what we call it. So let's get everybody together in the room that has some skills in data analysis or some skills in investigations. Let's get them together and let's work for a week on the Hansa Bay, yep. The Hansa Market service. And that kind of work is what we should strive for if we want to have more investigations coming to a fruitful end. And so it's two ways. It's being more creative. It's also being more creative with the methodology that we have nowadays. But it's also capacity and just persistence, I suppose.
And I agree with what was said previously. And I think one of the issues that we have in the US especially is the volume. And it's not just the volume of content whether or the types of investigations, it's the volume of the investigations being worked by law enforcement. And what I mean by that is, if I'm working on an investigation at the federal level in Phoenix, and there's a municipal police agency somewhere else in the US who could have a parallel or a similar investigation, there isn't really an effective central clearinghouse. I mean, we talk about certain entities such as perhaps NCMEC or other organizations being this theoretical clearinghouse, but the volume is so massive that there's data sitting there and it's just too much for people to look at and start connecting the dots. And I think as law enforcement, we need to do a better job of communicating amongst ourselves. And then again, we've discussed that there's this, I don't want to say animosity, but there's often this distrust from law enforcement to communicate with academia. And we found that, like today, my aha moment was the stuff that we're seeing in the field is absolutely being replicated in studies. And if we could figure out a way to take that information that we're seeing in the field and get it back to academia, I think that would help us further.
I think the idea of the design sprint is great. In Canada, the government every year on cybersecurity has a geek week. So they bring in students and teams from private corporations to address a problem or a set of problems using sanitized data. So they do not need to have any clearance, but the data they're manipulating reflects real data that could be applied using the technologies being designed to solve the problems. And actually in 5 days, what you can achieve and the new products you can develop is just amazing. So maybe we need a geek week for cyber criminologists, where law enforcement brings in problems and data that's sanitized, and then we see what the students and the private sector and the cops can do together.
Yeah. Thank you. And if there was this database of all the police operations ongoing in the States, I would love to have access to that database. And just to pick which investigation I would have access to, that would be awesome if you want to make it happen. The other question that I had that I think is pretty interesting is, how far do we go as researchers as well as law enforcement? So, Yap, you mentioned that at some point law enforcement was running the biggest market on the dark web, and there was a lot of ethical questions about the police being, in a sense, the biggest drug dealer on the dark web, if you excuse kind of the expression. But there's a question as, how far do we go as law enforcement in our investigations, but also for us as researchers, how far do we go in terms of collecting data? How much are we gonna lie? How much are we gonna hack into forums to have access to private communications? Kind of what is the line not that we shouldn't cross, and where do we stop basically?
Yeah, well, you gave an excellent example, and that's quite a difficult question to answer. But I think it's also about, a courage. And everything in the Hansa investigation or takedown was commissioned at a very high level, so everything was according to the law. And there were a lot of measures taken in order to prevent the cops running the site from becoming drug traffickers. Nevertheless, it is still seen as quite a courageous operation. But I think if then you can use the the legal framework in order to have such an operation and gather that much data that will solve other crimes, it is probably worth doing so. But for example, Hansa was quite convenient market because they excluded child sexual exploitation, they excluded murder for hire, they excluded weapons. And if we would find weapons somewhere, we would have to intervene immediately. And the general discourse was, you know, the drugs were already being traded. It's not that we took over the site and lured people into trading. It was happening already. We were just running the site in order to gather enough evidence to close it down. And yeah, how far, at least I think this went far to such an extent that it generated success. And it's probably the courts who are going to decide if it was all according to the law.
I guess we're lucky in one way in academia is that we have ethical boards, IRB boards, that limit us to a certain extent, where if we, you know, come into, if we know that there's harm that's going to occur to someone, we have to turn that over. I think where it becomes a little fuzzier, and I'm constantly surprised when we've done these projects together, David, that my university IRB, your university ethics board, treats the data that we collect as public in a way. Even though it's on the dark web, even though we're using Tor to get it, it's still considered public data. So it's not given the kind of scrutiny. Often we get our IRB through in a week. And for those of you not in academia, you know that's tremendously quick. Then it becomes more of the ethical dilemma. When we're collecting all of this data, when do we turn it over to law enforcement? Do we turn it over to law enforcement? Can we turn it over to law enforcement? And I know you've grappled with that in some of the data that you've collected, so maybe you're the person to answer this question.
And kind of a reference, I mean, one of the research projects I was invited on very recently, one of the instigator of the project, one of the things they wanted to do is to say, we're gonna send emails with tracking images to all these guys on the forum, and then we're gonna collect all their IP addresses for the participants, and then we're gonna map out where all these participants are located in the world. Well, you know, that's kind of a question that I had to ask myself is, do I wanna start tracking offenders? What do I do with this data? As Benoit said, how do you save this data? Because as soon as I have this data and Austin hears about it, he's gonna send me a search warrant to get this access to this data, and then what do you do with this, basically? So I think these are really interesting questions, and I have a tendency to collect as much information as I can very often. But it is, you know, the Hansa was a very good kind of event to kind of debate as to how far do we go, how far do we hack back. And I don't know, so in the States, the operation that we had, you know, with, you know, law enforcement running the market, is that something that could happen or has happened?
You know, it's very difficult to, it's not, like you were saying, up, it's a very complex answer. I mean, I once had a prosecutor explain it to me, he's like, you know, we don't want to be creepier than the bad guys. And it's not a hard line in the sand necessarily. You have to look at the totality of the circumstances. So I think the concept is you're going to, you know, does the good outweigh the bad? Now, obviously, there's certain legal things we cannot do, right? We cannot violate, you know, the law, the Constitution, or, you know, certain other aspects, policy. Oftentimes, policy is stricter than what the law allows to protect, the law enforcement agency or the agents from liability. But I definitely think it's something that should be explored. Like in our investigations in child exploitation, we're often asked, you know, well, you were present, you saw this horrible thing happen, doesn't that make you culpable? And our argument is back as it was, this may not sound appropriate, but it was happening anyways. By being present, at least we can, you know, intervene and hopefully stop it. And if we can't stop it, maybe we can identify somebody. So it's not like we were instigating it, you know, for example. Now, again, in the US at the federal level, we're very careful to work with our prosecutors to come up with, you know, a specific ethical lines that we can and cannot cross, meaning even if the law says we can do it, is it something that we want to do? Do we want to be creepier than the people that we're investigating?
So creepy, no. That's where, draw the line at creepy. Okay, that's a good, it's like do no evil by Google. So.
The ASC now has a division on cybercrime. Maybe this is a question for the division on cybercrime to examine and all the researchers, member of this division, to kind of look into it and on a collective basis and try to decide, because the quantity of data that we can collect is much bigger than any other group of criminologists doing on-site observation or even getting some police records. You know, we can collect at scale. If you have, even without an infrastructure, you can just rent out with a credit card a cloud capacity and collect millions of data points instantly almost. And that's something that we should ethically kind of consider very carefully when we do our research.
Another question that I think is really interesting is about the low-hanging fruit, something that I touched on in my presentation. So law enforcement in our interviews that we did with them often said that, you know, they could only arrest the low-hanging fruit, the unsophisticated users. And the question that I have for you is, do you feel as law enforcement or researchers that you're only studying or arresting or investigating low-hanging fruit? Do you think that you actually have access to these sophisticated, you know, actors, this mythical Russian hacker who's, you know, all-powerful that we always hear about? Do you feel as though we have the ability to investigate and research the whole gamut of offenders online, or are we limited in what we can do?
I think that's a question that has to be looked at based on the law enforcement agency that you're dealing with. You know, certain law enforcement agencies have a far greater capacity. Again, in the states, at the federal level, we have this ability to do long-term investigations. My job and some of my colleagues' jobs are to spend time on the internet just infiltrating networks. You know, I'm not expected to have so many cases cleared by the end of the week or so many arrests. I have a different job. If it's a local law enforcement agency, perhaps, you know, whether it's in Canada or US or a municipal agency somewhere else, they have, it's a quality of life issue. They have so many cases that they have to clear, they have a volume that they have to get through, and if they're not making arrests or not clearing cases, they have to answer to someone. So I think it's something that can absolutely be done, but it has to, the concept of low-hanging fruit, you know, is a term I don't like. Because we never know until we get in the door, correct? It's a perception, it's a misperception. But that can be something that can be handled at the local level, perhaps. You know, it's an offender in their jurisdiction that they can handle, and then the big, large networks or the masterminds can be handled by either task forces or federal agencies or specifically trained teams.
If I may add to that, because you know, it's very easy to say, you know, the big ones, the developers, they are somewhere in Russia or Eastern Europe. But if we look at the arrests, if we are able to arrest the admins already, even though there are others, then I think we already achieved a higher level than low-hanging fruits. There's another thing, and that's also what Austin is referring at. On these forums and on these dark web, youngsters can start knowing nothing, and in 3 months' time, they can be traders. And that is so rapidly evolving that cannot speak of low-hanging fruits anymore. But of course, you have to set your targets as an investigator or an investigative lead. And that means that sometimes you will ignore the low-hanging fruits and you will go for the ones that are a little bit higher up.
And I know, Benoit, you work with Dark Code, which was a supposedly extremely elite form of hackers online. Having done research on this forum, for example, do you feel coming out as though you had the chance, the opportunity to study some extremely talented hackers in this case? Was this kind of a breakthrough and a different experience given to the other forums? How was your experience doing that?
I would say I found out that hackers are like professors. They are deeply flawed. So, you know, what those forums showed me is that even the super elite hackers, they have this kind of little conflict, petty conflicts, and they're not super users. You know, they're mythic. We have to get rid of this mythical idea of the super user. And as Yap said, we also have to understand that even a beginner hacker can do a tremendous amount of damage. So, you know, we have to kind of account for a more blurred kind of narrative, a bit more nuanced, and not kind of look for the elusive super hacker that is hiding in Russia somewhere and controlling every single cybercrime ring in the world. I think it doesn't exist. You have, like, you know, people developing and very quickly sometimes and taking over, and but still with very sometimes problematic operational security that makes the work of the police in terms of disruption and arrests possible. So I think we have to be maybe a bit more attuned to the complexities of those communities.
Thank you. Thank you. If you guys have any questions, please do jump in at any point. I have a million of them, but do raise your hand if you want to ask a question. Oh, we have one over there.
Thank you very much. And so I have a comment first, and this has been extremely valuable to me. I teach a lot of law enforcement around the country about how to work undercover online as a child sexual predator or a child victim. And a lot of information will be used in this training going forward. But my question is sort of veering off more in the offender realm. Have any of you done research on offender characteristics and multiple presentations they mentioned that feeling of belonging or like-minded people or that grooming of these suspects online by people working undercover, is there an easier way to get them to release that information, get that feeling of belonging quicker? Because some of these investigations online, I mean, we just finished a 2-year undercover operation on a guy, and it took very, very long time for him to travel to Wisconsin to be arrested. It would have been nice if we could have done it in a couple weeks, and it was that grooming that took so long. And just looking to see if there's research out there to see where that line is that we can get to quicker, to groom them quicker, to identify themselves or release information that they have online about themselves so we can identify them and get them to travel quicker or find out who they are.
Well, that's a very good question and a very difficult one as well, because what I've noticed online that on the one hand, trust is formed much quicker and more easily, I think, because people are also, you know, in their own safe environment, so they don't have to show everything about themselves. So maybe trust is formed more easily than like in organized crime groups in real life. But on the other hand, what I've noticed in those child exploitation networks is that initial communication goes quite quickly, but then when it comes to the real personal stuff and maybe, you know, the stuff that might lead to an identification, that takes a while. So I also think it may, we may have to accept that this, grooming process, as you call it, may take a while. So I wouldn't be able to give you any real advice. What I have noticed, I've done actually a study looking at offender profiles online. And what we've actually noticed is that the great majority of them, they don't communicate an awful lot. So they come online and they post a few messages because they have to you know, stay active within the forum. And there's a couple of more profiles of people who really want to portray themselves and who want to climb up the ladder of the hierarchy and who want to become really famous forum members. And I think, you know, they might, because of they are in that process, they might be more willing to share information because they're so ambitious. And there's other people that we've noticed, it's a very small group, but people who escalate, so who very quickly increase the number of messages that they share and who also start communicating about more graphic topics. So I would say when it comes to choosing the offenders that you start communicating with, those two groups, you know, you might be more likely to have an effect. Yeah, that's... unfortunately all I can say, but I'll get back to you when the research finds more.
And if I may add, I've done more investigations and, you know, with offenders more on the fraud and hacking side, and stroking their egos is possibly the best technique there is. If you contact anyone, you tell them how great you think they are, they will tell you anything that you want. And it's pretty just, I'm always kind of impressed by how much information they're going to share. And the other thing that I've also discovered was, at least in the fraud world, offenders will call you and they really want to talk. And that's, countless times, you know, I'm talking with people on Wicker or Telegram, and they just call me up and they want to talk to solve a problem. If you make things drag along a lot, they will just, you know, call you, in, you know, with an audio phone. And so it's really interesting to me because it's easy for me to say, well, I don't want to talk to you. I don't want you to have, you know, a voice print or anything. But if I was doing real investigations and law enforcement, then you actually have them talking to you. So, and just by, especially we're in Quebec, if they speak French, then we know they're likely in Quebec. It gives us a lot of information about who they are as well. So I think that's kind of something that I've discovered that would be really interesting. But stroking the egos and just making it complicated to talk, very often they'll just say, okay, I'll pick up the phone and talk to you to solve this issue. And I found that that worked pretty well.
I don't know if there is specific research that addresses your need, but there is a center in the UK called CREST, which is funded by the MI6, MI5, Home Office, the Metropolitan Police, and a number of other law enforcement and intelligence agencies, and they do this kind of research, threat assessment, eliciting of information among informers, other types of research, very psychological-driven research, and they might have some answers to you, for you, and if not, maybe the US government might be willing to fund some research with the UK government on this, and you might have your answer. But they're doing some really cutting-edge work on these kind of questions. Very operational, but based on evidence, type of very strong evidence from psychology and other fields of research.
So we are getting to the end of this day. So I do want to thank all the speakers that were with us today. So if you want to help me applaud them and make sure. And as kind of my last words for today, and we can wrap it up after this, what I hear is, you know, there's both on law enforcement and researchers appear to want to work together. That's what I'm hearing today. So the main question is, how do we make it happen? We can talk about that all night if you guys want. But I always tell my students when they go to a conference that their only duty is to make one new friend at this conference. And so over time, they're going to get, you know, 1,000 friends, and it's going to help them with their networks and everything. So I hope all the law enforcement today are going to connect at least with one researcher, and there's a research project that comes out of it, and vice versa. And I think I hear that we're building trust and building relationships. And I think that, you know, law enforcement, universities, you know, we have a lot of cheap labor, basically, lots of students, lots of researchers who want to study data. And what we're missing is basically the fuel, the data, the evidence that is gathered. So hopefully we can, you know, make a few match happen in the coming months and years. So thank you everyone for being here. It was really lovely, super interesting. And I suggest that it's 3, almost 40. We're going to have to bring our stuff upstairs and everything. People who want to join us for drinks, we're going to be going to the 222 Tavern, so it's pretty easy to remember. We can meet on the street level near the elevators at 4 p.m., so it'll give us a little break and time to refresh a bit. And once again, everyone, thank you for coming in, and we'll see you guys this week at ASC Round. So thank you.